and factual reporting.
Follow the Minister of Local Government and Community Development on Instagram and X at LocalGovJA. The time by the ministry is
9:01.
You're inside the Consumer Hour with Nora Gay Banton.
Good morning, good morning, good morning to you. It is Tuesday. It's Tuesday, April 16, 2024. We are alive and well, and for that we give God thanks. If you have not yet left your house, I'm very happy for you that you're home. I would love to be home right now. Well, you know, we have responsibilities and we have to work, so we are out. But if you're listening to us from the 90 FM band, 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9, thank you so much for joining us on your radio. We do appreciate your company there, those listening to the radio in the car, in the kitchen, in the bathroom, in the living room, in the workplace, in the business place. Good morning to all of you. For those listening and watching on our YouTube channel, good morning to you. Those on our channel, Nationwide 90 FM Live, Nationwide 90 FM LIVE. Good morning to all of you. I'm seeing Herman. Is this Herman Hyatt? Good morning to you, Herman. How are you this morning? SH, good morning to you. KMC, good morning, good morning. Errol Townsend, big up yourself, Errol. Natalie Higginson, good morning to you. Albert Morgan, Anne-Marie, Cherry Care, and all the others joining in on the YouTube channel this morning. Good morning to you. Thank you so much for joining us on this platform. If you have not yet subscribed to our channel, please do so. Click the subscribe button, also click the notification bell so that you can be notified whenever we go live or whenever we post a video. If you're listening from our mobile app, which is available for free on the Google Play and the Apple App Store. Good morning to you and those on our website, the Listen Now option there. Good morning to you as well. Thank you so much for making it Nationwide 90 FM. It's the Consumer Hour. I'll be with you until just a couple minutes to 10. At that time, Cliff Hughes Online will take over. But in the meantime, inside the Consumer Hour, we take your calls. The numbers to call: 876-630-937124 or 618-8255. Those are the numbers to call if you have any consumer-related matters. And if you tried everything, well, you think you are able to do and your issue is still existing, then you can try us. We'll try our best to assist you as best as possible. Before we go to the phone lines, and also you can leave your comments in the YouTube chat if you... news commentator JA, you're so funny. If you have any consumer related issues, you can leave it in the chat as well. All right. So before I go to the phone lines though, Wayne, you called us about a JPS matter, and I told you that I would have handed over your information to JPS a little late, so you had to call back on Friday. We're having an issue with your account details. So if you can give us a call, Wayne, just give us a call and just give us the account number again so that we can sort it out. Or JPS has been trying to reach out to you. So if you see a missed call from a number a couple of times, it may be JPS trying to reach out to you. So give them a call back, or you can call us back and see, let's see if we had the account number Right. All right. So Wayne, who called about the JPS issue, please give us a call back or please try to reach out to JPS again. They've been trying to get back to you with your account number. All right. We have a call on the line. Richie, good morning.
Good morning, Ms. Genius.
Good morning, Richie. How are you?
Oh, I'm feeling pain as usual.
Pain. Wow.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know what is my pain?
Tell us.
Flow.
Oh, Lord.
Listen, and I would love for you to call, see if you can get it in. I mean, I know you won't help me,
mm-hmm.
but you can't help me. So I would really appreciate if you could get to Mr. Vartam. I'd love to talk with you.
Right, but...
Mr. Nara, yeah. Nara, I can't believe what is really going on. The first thing I'm going to tell you, as you should know, the 28-day plan moved from 3,100 to 3,500. And the only way flow can be worse is if it goes down completely. What I realize, the last numbers I'm getting from people recently, I call them, even in front of them, the phone is not ringing to them. Even yesterday I was in Hood Harbor. I'm going to pick up from Sunday evening. I sent a message to one of my sons. And I said, Green, so I said, read it. And hours after that, I called him and said, I'm telling him he's not finished loading. That's Sunday, no? Last night, I was talking with my doctor and said, I'm going to call her back. And she called back. And it just come like a text, like a message. And I can just continue. The last number that I get in Nara,
mm-hmm.
I call them, they're not getting, I'm not getting them. As I said, yesterday, I get a number from a lady. And I ring the phone, it doesn't answer. She called me, my phone didn't ring. And she called me and said, phone and it ring. You were saying?
Mm-hmm.
What I realized, the last numbers that I'm getting, they're not ringing in at all. The first one's not too bad. You know, just a while ago, I was in talking to Harrick. Harrick said he's not getting no service any at all from last week. You understand what I'm saying? So is at his worst, and I believe for to the worst, it has to go down completely. And no, this is service. I'm
You got low there.
Is it better?
No, you sound like you're covering the microphone, or I'm not sure what's happening.
Is it better?
Yes, go ahead. Yes, go ahead.
That's how the phone is behaving. I said, even this morning I was talking to Harrick. He said he's not getting no service any at all from last week in Ridge Flow. And even last night, a man came to my house here. And he took my number, and I ring his phone. He ring my phone, and until now, it's just a buddy, and it's not me alone complaining. Our people that I talk to with Flow Service, that's what they keep saying. Flow is at his worst, and the hoe you hire is there. Don't care about us. You understand what I'm saying?
You have a phone from the other network?
I used to use this cell, but I'm not using it anymore.
Why?
Not about to tell you. When Flo went down, I went to this cell, and it was $2,400 per month for the 28 days. Moved to 6, moved to 8. And I moved from here to 3,001, and I decided that I'm not going to pay it anymore because I'm not getting any good service anymore. The lady at this cell sent me to a payment to pay $2,700 per month. And I pay from February to June. Once a year, one day that I tried to make a call, and they said they have no service left. I went back to payment, so they said, Bill, I don't have any. I went back to the lady at this cell. The lady hooked me up with one at the head office. The lady said, it's tax, $1,000 tax. And I decided I'm not going to pay it. One month after, I decided I'm going to pay it because I need service. I went back there. They said, me owe $5,200 for tax. And I was in this line talking to the lady. The lady said, must come out of the line.
All right. So it's safe to say you're not satisfied with the service of Digicel. And so you're with Flow, and you're now not satisfied. So you're saying shut down Flow, and then what?
No, I'm not asking to shut down. We need another telecom provider.
Okay, and we don't have it right now. So what?
But what?
Yes.
I would like
what's the solution?
From Mr. Vaz, what is the plan for us?
Have you written to the ministry? Richie, before you say anything else, do not, I hope you're not coming to tell me, and I know you listen to this program, I hope you're not coming to tell me, nobody now listen to me, or nobody now do this, or nobody, have you tried?
I would not try because you know where it's coming
out. Okay. And you know, that's where I stop listening.
Because you know what that means.
Mm-hmm. You haven't tried anything. You are just here.
Listen to me. You know where I am at now? I'm planning. I keep telling my cousin this and he don't want me to say it. But see, before the end of this year, I plan to go to Trinidad. I've been called a man down there for this to find out what the service is like down here.
Okay.
And if I'm not getting anywhere, I will move to Trinidad.
That's your choice, you know, Richie. That's your choice, Richie. To be very honest, that is a choice that you would have to make. You would have to weigh the pros and cons and assess your own life and then decide on that.
Exactly.
But I am saying to you, and I've heard your cry, but, and of course, we can ask the minister. But I'm saying to you, Richie, as a citizen of Jamaica, and I know there are challenges with reaching out to some of these ministers, because really and truly, an issue with Flo should not go to the minister first. That's all the way up at the top of the food chain. Flo has managers, Flo has an executive board, Flo has a CEO, Flo has all of these other people. So before we get to a matter with Flo, before we get to the minister for a matter with Flo, I believe Flo can respond. But you're saying you're beyond that. You're beyond that. And you really don't want to hear from Flo anymore because they have done nothing to fix the issue. You want to go straight to the minister. But you have not tried.
But as I said to you, Flo system is overloaded because they're giving new customers new code numbers. And it's a problem because I prove it.
Yeah, Flo has, as far as I know, Flo has been using the new area code, so they shouldn't be bombarded with new numbers shouldn't be an issue now because they've moved on to the new area code, and there should be a whole list of numbers with the new area code because, as far as I know, you can now start over basically with the new area code.
But I don't know about that will work now. But the problem is, I'm having a problem, and it's like I'm going to tell you something, Nara. You see, in terms of customer care in Jamaica, I am not the only person. If you should call this place and they tell you to hold this and hold that, then you see them hold until the end of the
You know what you can do then? The other people that you know are experiencing the same thing you're experiencing, come together, and try a class action.
A class action like what?
A lawsuit against Flo. Get a lawyer.
It's something that I've been talking about, you know.
Yeah, man. Find the other people and you guys come together. Pool your resources together and try that. Maybe Flo will respond at that time.
I didn't know what's the worst part about Nara. I use my phone to do business.
Yeah.
That's the problem, you know.
Or maybe you can try about the other network and see if they've gotten any better.
No, I'm not going back.
The options are slim, my friend.
No, listen to me. The lady at the cell.
Okay. All right. Well, you're not all right. You're not going back there then, and you're staying with Flo. Well, maybe a suit is the next option for you to get them to act. All right? We don't have much time. We have to go to the break, Richie.
Okay.
All right. We take a break and come back with more Consumer Hour.
Decorate and redecorate your space with water-resistant, colorful, and fast-drying paints from Edgecam Paints. The time by Edgecam Paints, changing lives 1 gallon at a time, is
9:15.
Come to Framart Jamaica Limited for your one-stop framing, graphic design, and printing needs. We frame photos, certificates, paintings, t-shirts, and so much more. We print banners and print on canvas. You can also get high-quality prints and framing done in a quick turnaround time to fit your budget. Visit Framart Jamaica at 22C Old Hope Road, Kingston 5, Monday through Saturday, 8:30 a.m. to 6 p.m. Call us at 876-929-3058 or visit us at info@framartjamaica.com. Serving you for more than 30 years.
Celebrate 25 years with IQ Optical, your trusted eyewear provider. Enjoy 25% off your prescription eyewear and sunglasses, April 9th to 20th. Book your appointment or take your prescription to IQ Optical, New Kingston, Meta Park, or Draxall. Conditions apply.
Don't miss out on the Homeowners Expo at IREC 2024. Join us from Friday, April 19 to Saturday, April 20 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Come and experience everything for your home. The latest in smart technologies and innovative solutions and vibrant displays with live demos. There's something for everyone. Kids Corner, exciting entertainment and amazing prizes. Admission is free. Visit irec.realtorsjamaica.org. See you there.
Good morning, good morning, good morning. You're back here inside the Consumer Hour on Nationwide 90 FM. I'm Nora Gay Banton. We're taking your calls this morning. The numbers to call 876-630-9371-4 or 618-8255. We're taking your calls with your consumer-related issues this morning. And Wayne is on the line. Good morning, Wayne.
Morning, Miss Nora.
Wayne, this is the Wayne that I asked to call us back.
Yes, ma'am. I listen to the program every day.
Mm-hmm. All right. So, did you get an initial call from JPS?
No. With the phone yesterday all day. I never leave the phone a second because I was looking forward to that call.
And it never ring?
No. Not from that thing.
All right. Stay on the line and give us your number again. Please?
Yes.
And also give us your account number again, okay?
Okay.
So just stay on the line and the producer will take your contact number and your account number. So just go slowly with the account number and the contact number, all right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. All right. The next caller on the line is Marcus. Good morning.
Good morning.
Marcus?
Yes, morning.
Yes, go ahead, Marcus.
Right. I have a problem with my... the Indian store. This is Indian store in a plaza in Africa.
All right, don't call any names just yet. Just go ahead with the issue.
Right. But what happened, I went to the store, I saw component setting.
Mm-hmm.
So they say they would take, we call it a pay down 15 days.
15 days?
No, that's 15 days. They can do make payment until they finish.
Right. Yeah, installments. You paid installments?
Right. So, what happened is that I got one of the components from my daughter, so I went back and told her that I wasn't going to need a set again because I got one as a gift.
Mm-hmm.
So I willing to use what I paid out to something from the store.
Hold on. I think I missed something. So you went to the store, you saw the set, and you agreed to pay down on it in installments,
yes.
Right? So what was the arrangement? What was the arrangement? You would get the piece of furniture and then you pay down, did you pay a deposit or what was the arrangement?
They call it layaway plan.
So okay.
You pay until you finish pay for it, you get it.
All right. Good. Okay.
Right. Okay. So, make that payment.
Mm-hmm.
But I think like 3-4 weeks after that, I say I got one.
Oh, you got... Okay. So, you didn't want to pay on it anymore because you got one as a gift?
Yes.
Okay.
I went to him and I told him that I would just take something for that what I paid for.
Oh, you would just take an item for the money you already paid?
Right.
Okay.
he's saying it don't do that. I would have to continue to pay for what I made, paid him for until I finish.
He said so what? Go again?
He would not have to do that. I definitely have to finish pay for what I paid him.
All right. Before you go any further, did you sign any document of any form when you went into this contract with the owner of the store?
No, not at all. I just gave a receipt for what I paid.
And what did the receipt say? What did the receipt say you're paying?
Well, it don't want to specify nothing much. Should I pay X amount for that goods?
So how many? Okay, and your balance is?
Yes, X amount.
And you didn't sign, you signed this receipt in any, on any part of this receipt you signed?
No.
So all you did was verbally say to the store owner that you wanted to purchase this, what you said, combo rope or component set?
Component.
And they agreed that you can do it higher purchase? Our layaway plan?
Yes, layaway, they call it.
Layaway plan. And you paid an initial amount. How many times did you pay?
Two times.
Two times. Yeah, and both times, all you got was a receipt to say you paid, and then this is your balance.
Right. And if you get a second receipt, it was wrote on the initial receipt, the amount I paid.
So the first time you paid, you got a receipt, and when you paid the second time, you brought back the old receipt, and you wrote on the old receipt a new balance?
There's a
major issue here, sir, because there is no contract. The agreement seems to be solely verbal. And that is a major issue because it's now gonna be he said.
Mm-hmm.
And
well, at no time he told me that that would be the case. I would have to continue to pay for that item, whether I want it or not. Which I've been to several.
Okay, but to be fair, that wouldn't have come up because, as far as the arrangement is concerned, you are purchasing the component set, so it wouldn't have come up to say maybe you're not gonna want it down the line and you're just gonna want something for the $50,000 that you've already paid, for example. I don't know if it's 50. That wouldn't have come up because all this owner is concerned about is the piece of furniture that you agreed to purchase. So
Before I went to several of those stores and purchased stuff, and then I didn't go, but I go through the process.
And you just got something.
And then they refund me or buy something else.
Oh.
So I think this one will be the same.
Well,
it's possibly, but the thing, the price for the thing is like about 30,000. I think what I'd pay before is like 5,000.
Oh, so you only paid down like $5,000 on it?
Yeah.
Oh, and you just want something for that price?
Yes, I don't want to take something for that price. You say no. So it's
tricky because the store policy was not outlined to you in relation to that initially, and there was no contract where this policy would have been written and you would have signed. And the verbal contract that you have is that you're paying for the component set.
Right.
So, but you see where I'm going, though. The verbal. Right. So even though you didn't sign anything, there would have been a verbal contract. But the verbal contract with the owner is that you're paying for the component set. So now, essentially, because there's nothing written, essentially you would have broken that contract. Because that was what was communicated between you both.
Yes.
And but, as far as store policy, if you go and ask now, he's going to tell you that's what the policy is. But you don't know if that's what it actually is because you didn't know before. This is a tricky one. I'm happy it wasn't more money, but I understand that $5,000 is still money. And, I don't know. Maybe you can finish pay down and sell it back. I don't know, but... Or if you're willing to give up that $5,000, but I don't know. That's a sticky one. I don't know if you want, you can go and seek further legal advice. I don't know if you know any lawyers who would just advise you, not necessarily for a payment, but just to what your options are in this regard.
Right. What about the consumer thing you again?
Well, you can try the Consumer Affairs Commission. You can try. You can reach out to them. You can give them a call and let them know what the issue is. And maybe they can assist you there. Maybe you don't have to go through. Maybe they can just advise you as to what to do or what your rights are in this regard. But it's very unfortunate that there was nothing written.
Yes.
All right.
I said the most time I shop with those people at the first time.
Right, but you see, every store is different and every store has their own policy. And so that's just the case for this store. So that's just the case right now. All right? So you can seek legal advice from a lawyer or you can try to reach out to the Consumer Affairs Commission and they should also be able to guide you, okay?
Try that.
All right, no problem. Yeah, man. Carol, good morning. Hello, Carol. Carol, are you there? All right, Carol isn't there. Alaric, good morning.
Hey, Nora, how are you?
I am good, Alaric. How are you?
I am bad, Nora. Flow.
Oh, jeez. Flow. What's wrong with flow now?
I woke up last Wednesday morning, Nora. No internet.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm on the yard on roads. Yes. I don't owe any bills. I called them four times on Wednesday to let them know. Gave them all they asked me some questions. I gave them all the answers.
Mm-hmm.
And they said to me that somebody from the unit that looks at those things will get to me within 12 hours and talk to me because there might be a problem in my area. Nothing Wednesday. Call them Thursday morning, same thing. No call from them. Call them Friday, call them Saturday. Same thing every time. Somebody will call you in 12 hours and get to you. We are checking to see if there's a problem in your area.
All right.
Nora, I went to the Mandeville office yesterday.
Mm-hmm.
And all that they were able to tell me is that they are checking to see if there's a problem in my area and it's going to take 3 to 5 working days for them to get back to me. So that's all of last week now. So 3 to 5 working days from yesterday is going to take me up to Friday again this week. I can't watch nothing at all. I can't watch you guys on YouTube, nothing.
So you found out that it's a problem in the area or is it your...
I don't know because there were some people near to me having a problem and it said it took them 9 days for a day to get it addressed. But at that time, I saw because it looked like a truck had torn down one of their wires.
Oh, so what I'm trying to find out, if you don't know if there's an issue in the area now.
The lady was telling me yesterday that she's checking to see if there was a problem in the area. And then they come on the radio and they said there's a problem in Manchester and St. Anne, so they're apologizing. I don't hear they said there's a problem in St. Elizabeth.
All right, so... Flo, where are you, Alaric?
Ridge District.
Ridge.
Junction P.O. Central.
Flo, I'm just checking to see if I see anything myself from Flo. I don't know that Flo is very forthcoming with this kind of information either, though. But I'm checking just the same. Flo does a very good job at advertising, but not
that's all they know.
From not informing customers about outages. Hold on, Alaric. Let's take the break. Oh, all right. Let me just wrap this up quickly. So what we can do then is take your information, Alaric, just stay on the line, give the producer your information. We'll reach out to Flo. Flo, Ridge District in St. Elizabeth. No internet from last week. When again, Alaric?
From last Wednesday, from me.
Right. Okay, last week, Wednesday. All right. So stay on the line. Stay on the line, and we'll take your information. I'll take it and give it to Flo, all right? Because it may be an issue with yours. All right. Okay, so after the break, we'll have Inside Customs, so you won't hear me until about 15 minutes or so to the hour.
Spectrum Insurance Brokers provides quality insurance coverage and risk management services. The time by Spectrum Insurance Brokers Limited, setting the industry standards, is
9:31.
Welcome to Inside Customs, brought to you by the Jamaica Customs Agency, country above self.
Welcome to Inside Customs here on Nationwide 90 FM. This program is brought to you with the kind support of the Jamaica Customs Agency. My name is George Davis, and my guest today is Kingsley Henry. He is the Senior Director in charge of non-intrusive inspection and security management at the JCA. Kingsley, welcome to the program.
Thank you, George. My pleasure to be
good,
here.
Good. I've been tasked with asking you to tell Jamaicans about the physical intrusive inspection reform process, which of course includes the contactless clearance process, which is the subject of controversy, but that controversy is not the subject of this interview. So, therefore, Kingsley, for the layperson, what is physical intrusive inspection? What does that process entail?
Well, George, the simplest way to put it, and you're right, there are other matters that are happening in the public sphere, but we will address the facts relating to what we have come to call contactless clearance. So the ordinary person would be familiar with, let's say you ship a barrel, right? In layman terms, and you need to clear that barrel. So that barrel has arrived in Jamaica, and there are a lot of processes that is involving clearance. You have to give information to your freight forwarder. The freight forwarder has to submit a declaration to customs. You have to make payment, and then you'll get a call to say that you may come to the port to clear your barrel. When you come to the port to clear your barrel, you go to your freight forwarder, you get the paperwork, and then you move from your freight forwarder, you move over to the warehouse operator, you make some payment, and then you move to customs and you wait for the goods to be brought to the inspection area. Mm-hmm. When it comes to the inspection area, so the warehouse operator is bringing it, putting it in the inspection area, you stand and you wait for the customs officer to come to you, George. And when the customs officer come to you, the customs officer say, George or Mr. Davis, open your barrel, take the stuff out, go as far down to the bottom that I can see, mm-hmm. right? And the officer is there doing that while you are there. Sometimes you'd have waited hours. If it's in Christmas, you probably arrive in the darker morning and the inspection is taking place in the darker night. What contactless clearance is, customs is saying that we want to do that inspection without you having to be there or an agent having to be there for you. What we are further seeing with contactless clearance is that the default position of customs is that we will do the inspection without you being there. But if you want to be there, we'll provide an avenue for you to make a request to be there by sending us an email at ccp@jca.gov.jm to tell us that when your cargo is being inspected, you'd like to be there for the inspection.
But in terms of telling the JCA that I want to be there, it will then be up to the JCA to determine if you ought to be there.
Right. So the JCA will make a decision, right? And in most instances, we may agree that there is no reason why you cannot be present for the inspection. But what we want the Jamaican people and our customers to understand is that the way in which we inspect cargo now has been the way cargo has been inspected probably for centuries,
Yes. Right?
And in light of all the reforms that Jamaica Customs has been making over the years to make things easier for our customers, to make it easier for our officers, not only to collect the revenue, because people think about us as revenue collectors, but very importantly, to protect the borders, yes, to intercept arms, ammunition, illegal major cash, all of those functions before, that, yes, we carry out.
Yes.
We are saying, in line with all the other reforms, that contactless clearance is something that we want to offer to our customers. And we know some people may have various concerns that we can address, yes, and we have been addressing through the implementation. So I give you a quick one, George. So not so long ago, what the Jamaican people and our customers would have been used to is that when you go to clear your stuff, the customs officer would write the inspection report or the declaration on a piece of paper and send it to the cashier to pay.
Mm-hmm.
We have reformed the process by the introduction of ASICODA, Automated System for Customs Data. What happens now is that your freight forwarding agent submits your declaration electronically,
mm-hmm,
and then asks you to pay. So you're now paying for your barrel even before you get to customs.
Yes.
So customs is no longer seeing your goods and asking you to pay.
Yes.
You're now paying before. And people would have thought that that would have been an impossible proposition, yes, for the Jamaican people.
Yes.
And we're saying contactless clearance is just taking it a little bit further to say to people, you don't really need to be there. If you ship something to the post office, you're not there. Yes. You don't know that your mail and your passes are inspected by customs.
Yes.
You get them, don't it?
Yes.
If you buy something on Amazon and you send it, most Jamaicans are not even concerned about the inspection process.
Yes.
What you're concerned about is that you get what was shipped to, yes, you or what you order.
I can testify that I had cause to ship 2 barrels some time ago. It may have been 2 years ago or less than 2 years ago. I was in the States and I sent them home, and of course I did. And the process, I was surprised by how streamlined the process was relative to what I experienced with my granny. When I went there, my granny's, you go to clear a bottle, it's a whole day business.
Yes.
And it was frustrating on the number of steps. It was very much streamlined, and I planned for the whole day to do the process. But by mid to late morning, I was done, and I was saying, wait, we just go through the whole process, something right, because, well, I had my barrel, so I knew that everything was right.
Right.
But the point I'm making is this process has become increasingly streamed over time,
yes,
and you're saying that that was not been in the phase when you were trialing contactless clearance.
It could have been,
yes,
but one of the things that we're saying is that some of those improvements that you would have seen would have been as a result of other things that we have been doing.
Yes.
So change is constant, you know, right? So there's a lot of things that Jamaica Customs is doing. And when we look around the world and we travel and we've gone to South Korea, we've gone to the United States, we've gone to other countries. And what we're saying to the Jamaican people, the way that you see it happening when you come to the warehouse, with a warehouse inspection space that is full of barrels and full of crates and boxes, and when you look around, you're like, you're trying to find a customs officer,
yes,
because they are so overwhelmed and outnumbered, yes, in the space. The space cannot be secured. And one of the things that we must do as customs is that we must be able to conduct our inspection in a secured environment.
Yes.
And one way of doing that is saying to the Jamaican people, we'll put in the cameras, we will put in body-worn cameras for our officers, which we started last year. We will require warehouse operators and the handlers to have background checks,
mm-hmm,
security background checks done for the first time ever, to ensure that when you are not there and your cargo is being inspected, it is being inspected in a sterile environment.
And obvious benefit is the experience that I had several times going along with my granny. They'd walk past the barrel until they had them door seat. Yes, and you'll be there for the whole day until you tip somebody, and then the barrel will suddenly magically appear. Also, from my experience the last time, Kings, I can tell you, the longest block of time I spent was actually standing beside the barrel for them to be unloaded,
yes,
and inspected.
Yes.
But to take that out of it, I spent little to no time.
So, you're right, George. So the magic of it, right, is that what we are putting on the table for the Jamaican people is that once the freight forwarding agent has submitted the declaration to customs, and remember, the declaration can now be submitted once the manifest is in the system,
mm-hmm,
they can submit the declaration. So it is not unthinkable that when your barrel is being taken out of the container and being placed in the warehouse, the declaration is already in the system,
yes,
and paid for.
Yes.
Right? So once it comes out of the container, the next thing that we do is to scan the barrel. And that is something that I want to talk about a little bit later too.
Yes.
So we scan the barrel. having scanned the barrel, we don't need to dig up every single barrel. That is a part of the reform process as well, that we don't talk a lot about, right, because of the security sensitivity of it. But when we scan things, the aim is that we would reduce the number of times that we need to physically go into your barrel. Mm-hmm. So once your declaration is paid, come out of the container, it is scanned. If customs want to inspect it, we can inspect it now. Mm-hmm. But if we have to wait on you to come, what do you think going to happen? It's going to take a longer time for us to do the inspection. Yes. And what we want to be able to do is to do the inspection at the earliest point. So all you will have to do is come to the port and collect the barrel when you're informed that the barrel is ready. But guess what? Nobody have to inform you that the barrel is ready. Because you can now go on the mobile app, once you get your C number from your agent, and track the progress of your shipment through the customs process.
Yes.
That is change. That is first world.
That is first world. On the point of first world and change, we're going to leave it there for this week, but we're going to invite him back next week for a continuation of this conversation, because he did tease scanning of the barrel, which we want to get into, but we'll have to do it in next week's program. Kingsley Henry is the Senior Director in charge of non-intrusive inspection and security management at the Jamaica Customs Agency, and he was my guest this week on Inside Customs. Thank you, Kingsley.
You're welcome, George.
All right.
That was Inside Customs, brought to you by the Jamaica Customs Agency, country above self.
Demolition. We have the power tools for plumbers and electricians. Fancy leg tools, three parts and three repairs.
Three parts, three repairs.
In 2 to 3 years. Hilti, available at Delta Supply, 106 Hagley Park Road. Call us at 876-302-61114. Delta Supply, we service what we sell.
Hey mama.
They claim to want men who respect and treat women well, and like no other, a man's mother is the first exam to be tested, not true? Then why would a man treat his first love less just because he has a wife and a girlfriend? Is it a biblical thing about no longer clinging to the body of birth? On the other foot, being labeled a mama's boy means your dependency on a maternal figure is too deep for a grown man. No man not really giving him mother still. But wait, imagine a man who treats you like a queen throne and treats his mother like a question sign. Imagine a man full up your house of furniture and a 6-burner stove while mama there home a chop wood fire. Something can really go so. That a good man? Join me, Rodney Campbell, every Tuesday from 9 to 10:30 p.m. for Affairs of the Heart, right here on Nationwide 90 FM. This Tuesday's topic, when you're grown, who come first? Mama or your mate?
No one knows the pressure you bear, just only you. It's my words and my turn.
Brought to you by SuperMed Pharmacy. Super happy, super healthy, SuperMed.
If you're into real estate, then you're going to love this. Cliff Hughes Online will broadcast live from the second staging of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo, April 19 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. The expo will be from April 18 to 20. Hear expert presentations on April 18 and 19, then explore the Homeowners Expo on April 19 and 20. With giveaways, DJs, and live entertainment, it's the perfect outing for everyone, and the admission is free. That's a live broadcast of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo during Cliff Hughes Online, April 19 from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Only on Nationwide 90 FM, the new revolution in media. This broadcast is brought to you by 2020 Jamaica and Creative Building Finishes.
Fill all your prescriptions, get cosmetics and other pharmaceutical items at Mannings Hill Pharmacy, located at 34A Mannings Hill Road, Kingston. Telephone 924-6280. At Mannings Hill Pharmacy, they stock all the hard-to-get medication. The time by Mannings Hill Pharmacy is
9:45.
Don't miss out on the Homeowners Expo at IREC 2024. Join us from Friday, April 19 to Saturday, April 20 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Come and experience everything for your home. The latest in smart technologies and innovative solutions and vibrant displays with live demos. There's something for everyone. Kids Corner, exciting entertainment and amazing prizes. Admission is free. Visit irec.realtorsjamaica.org. See you there.
Good morning, good morning. You're back here inside the Consumer Hour on Nationwide 90 FM. I am Nora Gay Banton. I hope you enjoyed and learned something from that Inside Customs feature just now. I see a couple of our YouTubers commenting on the conversation during that segment. I'm happy you were able to listen and learn. Clash Camp saying 15 minutes run off fast when the conversation is beneficial. I'm happy that it was beneficial to you, Clash Camp, and I hope others listening were able to learn something from the Inside Customs segment. It should be on in this program from now on, so you can look forward to hearing Inside Customs inside the Consumer Hour. We have a couple minutes left in the show, so we open the phone lines again to you. If you have any further questions, concerns, consumer related, you can give us a call. The numbers to call: 876-630-9371-4 or 618-8255. That's 630-9371-4 or 618-8255. And of course, if you're unable to call, you can join us in the YouTube chat. We are not live on YouTube, Nationwide 90 FM Live. That's where we are on YouTube. Search that channel name and you should be able to find us. And you can leave your question, query, concern, comment in the YouTube chat. We have a caller on the line, Richie. Is this the same Richie calling back? Good morning, Richie.
My name is Nora. Good morning.
Oh, this is a different Richie. Good morning to you.
Yes, morning. I'm just calling to highlight certain things and see if you got here.
Okay.
Now, JPS is listening.
Mm-hmm.
Now, JPS move our meter from out of our house and put our card on the light post.
Yes.
And they promised to protect us from theft because they say the person that has the meter was just stealing the light.
Mm-hmm.
So they put it on the post.
Yes.
Now, we can't be in peace. The paying customer can't be in peace. I'm calling specifically from phase one, see if you got Butterfish pathway.
Which he pathway?
Because you have some persons go up on the light pole using the aid of the same JPS contractor, go up on the light pole and put on other person's light and paying customer's light in that box. Right now you have some old ladies here and they are billing 800,000, 500,000. A lot of complaints, and I've write to JPS. People complain to JPS. They go to the police. The police say, "A JPS."
They can't act on their own.
Right, and JPS can't give us any redress about this up until now. A lady get herbs right off, and it's because of consumer fears pressure them to write it off.
Mm-hmm.
What must we do? We must stop pay our light bill and start to keep it. As the other person,
you know,
pay by the rule is getting shafted. What do you do?
No, my encouragement to customers like you and others around you who are experiencing the same thing is pay what you know your bill usually comes to.
Right.
Pay that. Because if you can clearly see the theft happening on your line, you've written, you've spoken to, you've complained to JPS, and nothing is done. I know for a fact I would not be paying those exorbitant bills.
Right.
So because I know that I didn't rack up that amount on my bill.
Right. Even this morning, someone called me. I was on the road and told me that a ladder is on the light post. Right? When I come and see them taking on the ladder.
Listen.
Moving away with it. A lady have to move her pocket from beside the next house and put it way out on the front that it can be clearly seen because there were and the top of her button, just racking up her light. And when we talk, nothing.
You know, thank you so much for calling and highlighting this issue. And I don't think it's something JPS has really tackled in a serious way. We've spoken about this with JPS before, and the approach that I gather is a more, you know, accepting approach, not accepting of theft, but to say, let's try to make you legal. If they wanted to be legal, they wouldn't be thief in the light in the first place.
They don't want to be legal.
And my thing is, it's time to come down now with force.
Right.
It is, I think, JPS, to be very honest with you, it is time to come down on these thieves with force.
Simple, because the promise that they gave us, you know, all right, when they move our meter from out of our home and put it on the box, there's no way a person can thief it, because the item is so high.
And they found their way up there.
And they found their way up there every time. They found their way. I have some people are so scared. They don't want to speak. Because.
And I can understand right, that because right. We are a violent people.
Right. And last night, it's a little old lady. I ask a gentleman if he please can take off the light off his pocket now. That is pain, you know.
Listen, JPS, this is phase one. So I'm helping you now with the area where you need to go and see that electricity is illegal. Electricity connection is happening in Seaview Gardens. Phase one, Seaview. We have a caller here who is from the area, who is aware of the issue and has tried through other means to get your attention, JPS.
Right.
He's written to you, he's called and complained, but nothing has been done. JPS, I think the days of moral suasion is over.
Right.
They have to be over. All right, but thank you for calling, Richie. JPS, phase one, Seaview. If you need more information, give us a call and we'll tell you exactly where. Richie, stay on the line and give the producer your information. Just give her your contact number so that we can give it to JPS. Just stay on the line, give the producer your contact information so that if JPS needs more information about phase one in Seaview as it relates to electricity theft, they can get it. Stay on the line. Who's next on the line? The next caller is Dwayne. Good morning, Dwayne.
Good morning. How are you?
I am not too bad, you know, Dwayne. How are you?
You're just really hyped up this morning, man. But who wouldn't be? I believe I hear you calling out JPS.
Mm-hmm.
You think JPS don't know all these things?
And that is what I am saying. I don't think enough is being done by JPS. I think some of it is being overlooked. And as I said before, we've had the conversation on air about electricity theft. And the approach I hear from them is moral suasion. But I don't think we're at that point now where elderly people are being affected, getting, as Richie said just now, bills of $800,000+. That can't be right.
If you can't hold on, why you worry about doing what you have to do? You can't hold anybody for PAP.
It is not fair.
I am getting the money for it, so that's good. I don't have to worry. I don't believe that they're really serious about that. I believe that they're finding somewhere to pad near your bill to get whatever they want, so they don't care.
I mean, we do pay for it, though, and that's a known fact. We do pay for it. Across the island, we pay for those who...
So that's the reason why they don't have any drive to do anything. Because, you know what I can understand, you know, if you as a normal teen person, and you're out for 1 month, your life is going to get cut. And if you pay your bill one day after, you pay it, and you left 1 cent on the bill, they get to put the $250 on your bill for you to pay it, and so you never pay the whole of the bill. So if you get $1,000, and then you did just miss and never pay the 1 cent, you still can pay the $250 in a car, and say you should have paid the 1 cent. Same thing, if you pay well, and a month or two come on you and need to pay because you might be ailing or you might lose a job, just tell you, come in to cut off your light. But the man who, one thing I recognize too, the persons who have their light up, it burns right through the day and through the night.
Because they're not paying, they don't need to.
Yeah.
They don't need to.
If JPSB don't want to, they can just hop on there. Make it be a regular thing.
This is something I want to see if we can tackle with JPS on Friday when they come again. I'm going to try to remember so that whatever else we have to talk about, we can squeeze it in. But I'm trying to get another caller in after you, Dwayne. But thank you so much for calling.
What a quick question for you.
Quickly.
What happened to the digital number on your side? Could you check it out, please?
618-8255.
And you're not answering.
All right, we'll check it out and see. But as far as I know, it's working. But we'll check it out. All right?
But it's not answering.
Oh, okay. All right, then. All right, Carol, good morning.
Morning.
Good morning.
Yes, I was holding for you for a while, so I had to go.
Okay.
There's an ATM machine, ABM machine, Scotia Bank, in Monique, St. Anne.
Right.
This machine is always down, and I'm not exaggerating. For the last 2 weeks, the machine has been down. No service last week. This week, no. It looked like it working. When you go inside there, put in your card, it's a not in service. It is so bad that if you see somebody coming out of the machine, the first thing, is it working? When you hear that it's working, hallelujah. You're so glad.
So you're saying you've been trying for 2 weeks now in Monique?
No, it's not working.
Does the machine have they usually have a number on them? No. So that they're easily identified? No number?
No, I don't know the number. It's the only machine in Monique.
Only Scotia machine in Monique.
Only Monique then.
All right. Well, you know, the recent standards that were put out by the Bank of Jamaica.
Yes, I heard of that.
Good. So they will have to fix things shortly. Well, they should be fixing things now. But in the meantime, I can understand still those Scotia customers who would like to use the machine and others who would like to use the machine.
Right.
Would love for it to be working. Well, Scotia Bank, your machine in Monique, your ATM in Monique, it's perpetually out of service. And so the customers and those who would like to have access to it are asking you to just come and take a look. If there's an issue with the machine, try to get it fixed or communicate, you know, say something.
Can I add one more thing?
Quickly, because we have to go soon.
Yes, I called the customer service center, Scotiabank, and the young man telling me that they can't take a report about any machine and I must go into the branch. Yes. Right? Then eventually they're called too late. I must call back in the morning.
Huh?
Yes, ma'am. Then, by the way, I found out that it was Guardsman who serviced the machine.
Right.
So I tried calling Guardsman, and they said they can't take any report because it's a private matter.
Right, but it would be Scotia Bank who would need to communicate with Guardsman initially. So the point of contact, right, because they can't be the point of contact. It's Scotia Bank who hired them.
Yeah.
Right. Well, Scotia, once again, calling you out. Your machine in Monique, the ATM in Monique.
A rural era, right. Else is there.
Yeah, right. We can understand that. All right. So, Scotia, fix things. Please. The folks in Monique, they're trying their best to work with you, but you're not working with them. And the machine isn't working with them either. So if you can do something about that, Scotia, let us know and we can gladly relay that information for you. All right? Thank you so much for calling, Carol.
All right.
And that's where we're going to leave it for the Consumer Hour this morning. We make way now for Cliff Hughes Online.
Thank you.
The mission of the Ministry of Legal and Constitutional Affairs includes revising Jamaica's legal and constitutional infrastructure and accelerating the pace of reform. The time by the MLCA is
10 o'clock.
Cliff Hughes Online. Talk radio for all Jamaicans.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock. Like a rock. I was strong as I could be. Like a rock. Nothing ever got to me. Like a rock. I was something to see. Like a rock. And I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud, I stood tall, high above it all. I still believed in my dreams.
Our phone numbers are 630-9371, 630-9372, 630-9373, 630-9374, and 618-8255. Or find us on Facebook at Nationwide News Network and follow us on Twitter at Cliff Nationwide. You can also listen to Cliff Hughes Online live on the World Wide Web at NationwideRadioJM.com or via the Nationwide 90FM app on your mobile phone. Now, here's your host, Cliff Hughes.
Good morning. Good morning. Let's get to work.
Cliff Says is brought to you by Educom Credit Union, providing value through service.
Cliff Says, what's on his mind? Unfiltered analysis and commentary.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock. Like a rock. I was strong as I could be. Like a rock. Nothing ever got to me. Like a rock. I was something to see. Like a rock. And I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud, I stood tall, high above it all. I still believe.
Thank you so much for choosing to be with us this morning. Thank you so much. It's Cliff Hughes Online on Nationwide 90FM. And I want to say a special welcome this morning to members of the diaspora who are tuning in to us. Met a husband and wife last week, and they live in the United States. And they told me that the husband works with one of the airlines, and he says that his business place, there are several Jamaicans, and they gather at about this time in the morning to listen to this program and this idiot called Cliff Hughes. Yes? And I want to say to them, good morning and welcome. Yes, we appreciate your company. Yes, and to the many others in the diaspora who tune in to Nationwide 90FM. They tell me it's one of their leading sources of information about what's happening back home. I really appreciate that. This morning, I start with the news coming out of St. Anne yesterday evening that we have lost a member of the constabulary force. A constable, Ricardo Fairclough, who was shot in St. Anne's Bay last evening when he went to assist a woman who was attacked. Constable Fairclough is the first policeman to be slain since the start of the year. He was 45 years old. And according to what we're learning, Constable Fairclough was killed after he went to the assistance of a 24-year-old female vendor. The incident occurred about 8:30 last evening on Bravo Street in the vicinity of a popular supermarket in St. Anne's Bay. According to what we're learning from the police, the woman was standing on the street when she was approached by a lone gunman who shot her in the upper body. Constable Fairclough, who was nearby, responded. He fired his service pistol, and there was an exchange of gunfire between himself and the gunman. And Constable Fairclough, unfortunately, was also shot in the upper body. The gunman fled the scene on foot, and Constable Fairclough died later yesterday. The 24-year-old female vendor is also in the hospital in critical condition. Constable Fairclough was assigned to the St. Anne's Bay Police Station and resided in the town. The police are appealing to you, the members of the public who may have any information that may lead to the arrest of the gunman, to tell them what you know. And we say to the members of the force and to the family of Constable Fairclough, this is a very hazardous job that you choose to take on for your country. And here is a policeman who was doing his job. Yes, he saw a crime was about to be committed, and he responded. As a professional member of the constabulary force is expected to. Yeah? And he has paid the ultimate price, and for that, we must recognize him, and I hope the constabulary will do all it can to reach out to Constable Fairclough's family. Yes? And provide them with whatever support they ought to be given in this moment. Very difficult, you know, 45 years old. In the meantime, I see where the Commissioner of Police, Dr. Kevin Blake, has ordered a high-level investigation into the slaying of Constable Fairclough. He has also expressed his condolences on behalf of the Police High Command to the family of Constable Fairclough, friends and colleagues. Yeah. So sorry to hear about that. Then I'm also learning this morning that some other public servants, three firefighters were seriously injured after two this morning while trying to put out a fire on 7th Street in Greenwich Town in southwest St. Andrew. Apparently, based on what I'm learning, they came into contact with the high tension wires, or it is felt illegal electricity. It's not sure clear yet, but but they were hurt, injured, and all three are said to be seriously injured. One of the firefighters has apparently lost movement, mobility in a part of his body, and they are in hospital being treated. Yes. Firefighters and police take on a very, very difficult job, you know. And sometimes we don't pause and recognize them and give them credit enough for what they do. Yeah. At the same time, the constabulary force is telling us that the murder rate continues to trend down so far this year. We're at the 16th of April. We have completed one quarter of the year. We have begun a second. And the murder rate continues to decline. And that's good. That's good. We want that to be sustained. Yeah? So far this year, compared to last year, the fall in the murder rate is about 14%. 14%. Yeah? Shalois Michael has more.
According to the JCF, 311 people were killed between January 1 and April 13. That's 50 fewer than the 361 murders recorded over the corresponding period last year. Still, 19 people were killed across the country between April 6 and 13. The Portland Police Division continues to lead with the fewest murders, with two reports. That's the same number recorded for the corresponding period of 2023. St. James continues to hold the dubious honor of being the most murderous division. The parish recorded 41 murders as of April 13. That's 5 fewer than the corresponding period last year. St. Catherine South recorded 29 homicides, 3 fewer than last year's review period. Among other major crimes, shootings have increased by 3% during the period under review. According to the JCF, 308 shooting incidents were recorded up to April 13. Robberies have also increased by 1%, recording 195 incidents so far this year. Other major crimes, such as rapes and break-ins, continue to decline. Meanwhile, Police Commissioner Dr. Kevin Blake has credited the decline in murders to an increase in the seizure of illegal guns and ammunition.
Our work to ensure safety and security across Jamaica are ongoing and evolving, and it is crucial that we examine the data with a discerning eye to understand the landscape of crime in our nation and the effectiveness of our strategies to combat it. Our focus on illegal firearms has yielded tangible results. In 2024, there has been a 7% increase in gun seizures, with pistols being the most commonly seized firearm. Ammunition seizures rose by 41%, reflecting our intensified efforts to rid our streets of these dangerous tools of violence.
Shaloy Smichael for Nationwide News.
Thank you, Shaloy. And I'm just learning from a member of the JCF that the gunman, who it is believed fired the shot that killed Constable Fairclough last evening in St. Anne's Bay, that he's now in the custody of the police. Apparently he was picked up after he turned up at a hospital for treatment. And according to this member of the JCF, he was taken into custody, yes, for doing so. So, I suppose we'll hear more on that a little later today. But that's the word from a member of the constabulary force, yes? Just told me that the gunman was caught when he turned up at the hospital last night at 10:30. The incident happened shortly, sometime around 8:30, and he turned up at the hospital 2 hours later, and he was caught. All right? More after the break.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right, like a rock, like a rock. I was strong as I could be, like a rock. Nothing ever got to me, like a rock.
The Time brought to you by the Ministry of Science, Energy, Telecommunications and Transport. Fueling growth everywhere is
16 minutes after 10.
Educom is at it again with the EduPower Energy Loan. Cut your high energy bills with solar. Power up your home, business, or upgrade existing equipment. Access everything solar. Panels, water heaters, and much more. You've got the power with the EduPower Energy Loan. Borrow up to $3 million with up to 5 years to repay at competitive interest rates. Conditions apply. Call Educom at 876-926-6973 for more info. Educom Cooperative Credit Union Limited, providing value through service.
If you're into real estate, then you're going to love this. Cliff Hughes Online will broadcast live from the second staging of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo, April 19 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. The expo will be from April 18 to 20. Hear expert presentations on April 18 and 19, then explore the Homeowners Expo on April 19 and 20. With giveaways, DJs, and live entertainment, it's the perfect outing for everyone, and the admission is free. That's a live broadcast of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo during Cliff Hughes Online, April 19 from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Only on Nationwide 90 FM, the new revolution in media. This broadcast is brought to you by 2020 Jamaica and Creative Building Finishes.
I still locked to the Olympics because, of course, I'm Jamaican. What do you mean? Me, I have to tune into the Olympics, man. Because me always busy, but what? I have to know when Sherika Jackson beat Shakari.
Brother, I have to have every notification for the Olympics. I want to hear every run.
Now Sherika Jackson coming
every
up.
Every jump.
Oh, that is absolutely huge of way pink up.
And every fling, live.
So, take us then.
Nothing can miss me.
We're always on the move.
So while we're driving, run, Elaine, run.
Jogging. Yes. Run, Watson. Win again.
Watson is now a world champion.
Or even at work.
Quick, the race has started.
We can't miss a beat because we keep it locked
to the only station
for the Paris Olympics.
Nationwide.
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 90 FM.
Nationwide, 90.1, 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9. And on YouTube at Nationwide 90 FM Live. Nationwide, the new revolution in media.
Cliff says what's on his mind. Unfiltered analysis and commentary.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right, like a rock, like a rock.
19 minutes after 10 o'clock, and apparently Constable Ricardo Fairclough, who was killed last evening in St. Anne's Bay, was a man of God. He was quite a preacher. And apparently his killing is having a profound impact on several of his colleagues in the force. They've been reaching out to me, one of whom just sent me this, of Constable Fairclough, yeah, preaching, yes, as a man of faith.
I'm so excited about King Jesus. I'm so excited about
daddy Jesus. Jesus is my daddy ho. Hallelujah. And in this season where we pray, we stay, we fast, we last. Hallelujah. In this season, you got to keep your prayer line up. You got to keep your fasting life up, because the Bible declares that this time goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. It is the season that we put in abundance of prayer, abundance of fasting, because the weapon of our warfare, it is not carnal but is mighty through God to the pulling down of stronghold. And for us to pull down some stronghold, we got to learn how to fast. We got to learn how to pray. So we pray, we stay, we fast, we last, so we can pull down the stronghold in Jamaica, land we love, and right across the world. God bless you as we pray.
Constable Ricardo Fairclough, who was killed last evening in St. Anne's Bay when he intervened when a lone gunman attacked a vendor in the town, and during the exchange of gunfire, Constable Fairclough was shot fatally. Twenty-one minutes after 10 o'clock. The Constitutional Court is expected to rule on Friday this week on whether the second extension of the tenure of the Director of Public Prosecutions, Paula Llewellyn, is constitutional. You'll recall the controversy that erupted when the government extended for a second time the tenure of DPP Llewellyn. Well, the Constitutional Court will make its decision known at 10 this Friday morning. Yes, it's listed as the first matter of the day on the Supreme Court civil list for Friday. Now, here's the background to what is expected to happen on Friday morning, read by Dana Davey.
The opposition People's National Party, PNP, had challenged the second extension granted to Paula Llewellyn. That two-year extension allowed Ms. Llewellyn to remain in office beyond her 65th birthday. Leader of Opposition Business in the House, Philip Polwell, and his counterpart in the Senate, Peter Bunting, have agreed that the amendment was enacted for an improper purpose and is therefore inconsistent with the country's supreme law. They further argued that the amendments were done in breach of the separation of powers principle. The PNP has also argued that the amendment violated the spirit of the Jamaican Constitution. Lawyers representing the government have urged the Constitutional Court to reject what they say is a radical argument being advanced by the PNP. King's Counsel Alan Wood told the judges the government was on sound legal footing. During oral arguments, he noted the amendment was in keeping with the official government policy of increasing the age of public officials to 65. According to Wood, the extension of the DPP's tenure was not in conflict with any express provision of the Constitution, nor did it in any way weaken the office. He rejected the argument that the extension violated the separation of powers. He submitted to the court that there was no interference with the powers of the DPP, nor was there any attempt to subject the office to political control or interference. Mr. Wood told the court that judges should restrain themselves from inquiring into the motives of the government once the amendment has been shown to follow the proper constitutional procedure. The ruling will be handed down by Justices Sonia Wint Blair, Simone Wolf Rees, and Tricia Hutchinson Shelley. The PNP is being represented by King's Counsel Michael Hilton and attorneys Kevin Powell, Dwayne Allen, and Tamira Mason. Representing the Holness Administration and the Attorney General are King's Counsel Alan Wood and Ransford Braham, along with attorneys Nico Pagan and Catherine Williams. Were the People's National Party to prevail in this case, DPP Llewellyn would be required to demit office and proceed on retirement. Dana Davey for Nationwide News.
So that's coming on Friday morning at 10, and you'll be able to hear it right here of course. Inflation. Yes. The constant enemy of consumers. And consumers all over the world have been under the gun by the unrelenting increases in prices, the price of goods and services that we have to use. And we here in Jamaica have not been spared. Or inflation has been, like the rest of the world, been well outside of our target range for quite some time now. Well, there's a bit of good news this morning, because as of March last month, Jamaica's point-to-point inflation rate has fallen and back within that target range set by the Bank of Jamaica of 4 to 6%. It has been higher than that for well over a year, going 2 years. Well, according to the Statistical Institute of Jamaica, Statin, for the month just ended, March, the point-to-point inflation rate came in at 5.6%. This was 0.6 percentage point lower than the 6.2% rate recorded for the previous month of February. Now, is this going to be sustainable? Yeah? According to Statin, the main contributor was a lower rate of increase for the heaviest weighted division of the consumer basket of goods, food and non-alcoholic beverages. Yes, they contributed to the decline in the number. Meanwhile, the inflation rate for March was negative 0.5%. Yes, for the fiscal year to date, yeah, it's at 6%. Right? So, I hope you are feeling it when you go to the supermarket. Don't look at me in that tone of voice, David. I hope you're feeling it. Yes? And it will take some time. If it continues to moderate, to fall, it is going to take some time for you to feel it in terms of the reductions in the price that you have to pay. Yeah? NIDS. On the weekend, I saw from several sources a WhatsApp message talking about the NIDS. And the message essentially repeated all the wild lies about the purpose of the NIDS. Yes? And I said, but this can't be true. And I said, well, this is social media. And some people are now heavily invested in spewing lies. Yeah? So this morning, I heard the minister with responsibility for digital transformation, Senator Dana Morris, in an interview with Ricardo and George on the NIDS. And they asked her about this WhatsApp message. And she said what was contained in the messages are simply lies, untruths. And clearly the message was crafted to generate more confusion and anxiety and distrust. Yeah. Here's what Senator Dana Morris told George and Tona this morning.
There's tons of misinformation and disinformation. The first thing I have to say is that NIDS is voluntary. The regulations, the law that was passed made it very clear that this is a voluntary process. No one is ever going to be forced to get a national ID. That is in law. And so any WhatsApp or anyone who says you will be forced is not communicating the truth. And that's one of the issues we have in this climate, where anyone can come up with anything and it makes absolutely no sense, but it can get traction and it can get reach. And what I'm saying is it's voluntary. That's the first thing. So there can be no fine. In it, it speaks to a fine that's going to come if you do not do this. That is not accurate because it is voluntary. Now, obviously, we think that people, it will become useful for people because it's supposed to make their lives easier and their interactions with government easier. But if someone does not want to get the ID, they do not have to get the ID. And I think that it is very mischievous for people to be spreading lies in this manner and to put it out as a newsflash.
The other big thing from it, let me not even ask it that way. Let me ask it this way. A lot of what has been said in the WhatsApp message, to my memory, accords with the things that were struck down by the court in the original NIDS Act from 2017. So right. Is it your interpretation that what perhaps people have done is go back to the forerunning piece of legislation which the court struck down, drew things from that, and published it as what the current law seeks to do?
I think that's a part of it. And I think there's even more mischief to it than that, because it's even gone further than what the original law said. And the reality is the Supreme Court did rule. When you read the Supreme Court ruling, which is a very long and elegant ruling, and it's worth reading, you will see that embedded in the ruling was really a lot of concern. And this is my interpretation of the ruling, having read it, all of the words in it, is there was a deep concern about data protection. That was really a very critical element.
Yes, especially third-party exploitation, yes, of people's private information.
Exactly. And that is why the Data Protection Act has been promulgated, not just for NIDS, but NIDS is an important conduit through which we will see the benefits of the Data Protection Act. But the Data Protection Act is to secure all of that data so that it cannot be shared. And I'll give you one example in terms of what we're doing with the build-out of the NIDS system. Now, there are always going to be people who want to verify your ID. Even though when you give entities your ID or your birth certificate or your driver's license, there's some process, or your TRN, there's a process where they'll try to verify if the information you've given is correct. And someone will try to verify your NIDS information, like a bank. Let's say you want to open a bank account. That bank will call on the NIDS system and will check the number you've given and confirm that it is you. Now, what this system does, though, is it sends you an alert, either via phone, a text, or an email that says, this bank has verified your identification. Mm-hmm. What it means is that anytime any third party tries to verify, you will be notified. So if there is someone who you didn't authorize, you will always know,
yes,
that has happened. And that's how we're building in the trust into the NIDS system.
And on the matter, Minister, of doing business or having certain things done in the country, this message, yes, was saying as well that failure to get a national identity number and NIN will affect the registration of births, deaths, marriages, getting your passport, your driver's license, and conducting, for example, other commercial industrial services. Could you provide some clarity on that? Will not getting a NIN will hinder the conducting of business or getting certain registration documents?
I can say that that is complete rubbish. As I said in the beginning, the NIDS, your national ID, is voluntary. And if it is voluntary, and the court has ruled, and the law that has been promulgated is very clear in it that this is voluntary. And so if it is voluntary, there is no way that the state or the government can deny services to anyone. And I don't think anyone in the government would be trying to put in place a system that would deny these very important services to someone. And so this is why these types of WhatsApps are really dangerous.
Yes.
Because it sets these people on high alert.
Yes.
You know, people start to get scared when there is absolutely no truth to it. And it's very dangerous,
yes,
for our country.
Senator Dana Morris-Dixon, She's a minister with responsibility for skills and digital transformation, attempting to debunk that widely circulated WhatsApp message packed with lies and disinformation on the weekend about the NIDS. Yeah? You have to be very careful of what you read and, more importantly, what you believe, because there are people who deliberately, some of whom are now paid, to sit down and craft lies. Some for religious purposes, some for political purposes, some for social purposes, all kinds of agendas. Time for the break. After the break, your calls.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light. And I held firm.
Cliff Says was brought to you by Educom Credit Union, providing value through service.
It's One Jamaica, so make we clean up the place. The time brought to you by the National Solid Waste Management Authority is
24 minutes to 11.
The Olympic Games 2024 live from Paris in France, exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
The Jamaican star shines bright once again.
This summer, Nationwide 90 FM is coming in hot.
Jamaica to the blocks!
Nationwide 90 FM will be blazing as we bring you the games of the 33rd Olympiad live from the French capital, Paris. 16 fantastic days of competition in 41 sports.
Lovely Williams Mills coming!
The station will bring you analysis and live coverage from the opening day of competition, Friday, July 26th, to the very last day of action on Sunday, August 11th.
And some parchment! Let's go! Oh, what a run!
Everything and anything Paris Olympic Games 2024 can be heard right here on Nationwide 90 FM.
It is a glittering goal for Sharika Jackson, and how they will celebrate that back in Jamaica.
We'll capture the spirit of athleticism. We'll narrate the Olympic fever, define thrilling moments, and report on the blood, sweat, and tears of the world's greatest athletes. Nationwide 90 FM is going to the Paris Olympic Games, and we're taking you with us. Tune into Nationwide 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9 for live updates and commentary. We'll be giving the listeners a front row seat to witness excitement, triumph, and memories.
And I think it was a clean sweep for the Jamaicans.
Stay tuned to Nationwide 90 FM 24/7. Experience the Paris Olympic Games 2024 right here on the Revolution in Media Nationwide 90 FM, your Olympic Center. Exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
Our phone numbers are 630-9371, 630-9372, 630-9373, 630-9374, and 618-8255.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright, my walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light, and I held firm to what I felt was right.
21 minutes going up to 11 o'clock. We're going to get to the phones now and to our callers and our tweeps and YouTubers. Yes, YouTubers are out in their numbers as usual. Yes, Kirk, I see on YouTube, is asking whether the policeman, Constable Fairclough, was wearing a bulletproof vest. I don't know the answer to that, Kirk. Yes, I don't know. Yeah. SH says, may God comfort his family. Yeah. And Yvette says, oh my God, God knows best. Condolences to his family, says Maxine Wildman. Yeah. All right, Hewitt is our first caller. Good morning, Hewitt.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Yes, Hugh. I think I want to call you out on something this morning. Yes. Yesterday, and I think it was your Christmas,
Uh-huh.
You st- stated that the JLP, well, the government in question, saying, basically, you're saying that they said they lost the election, so they are doing a reshuffle. Am I to get you correct on that?
It's a little bit more nuanced than that, but go ahead.
Right. So, and I am calling you out now because I am tired of hearing people say Christians, Christmas say, and Christmas, you know? Yeah, I'm actually tired of it.
So why you listen to it? Why you listen to it?
Because I have to hear it, because I'm in this space where it is being said.
No, you don't have to hear it, but if you hear it, you don't have to believe it.
So.
You know, I woke up this morning to, let me give you an example. I woke up this morning to something some comrades sent to me. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Utilizing my commentary yesterday morning on the changes that, the political and government changes that we understand are in the works. And the spin they put on it, I said, boy, you know, it reminds me again that I'm used and abused. Yes? Used and abused. Yeah?
Let me tell you, sir.
And I don't know how many times I'm going to have to say it. Yeah? Well, let me say it again. Yes?
Yes, sir, obviously.
The days following February 26th.
Right.
And the final counts.
Right.
And results that we got about, was it a week or some days after the elections?
A week. Final says maybe 8-9 days.
Right. At the end of the count, the governing Jamaica Labour Party came out of those elections weaker than it went in.
Yes?
Yes. And unlike a general election, a local government election has different, well, let me use a term, yardstick to measure a winner or a loser.
Correct.
Yes?
Yes.
And the point is, and if the Labourites are honest, they will tell you quietly, they won't come here and say it publicly. They went in with what? 8-9 clear controlling councils. They came out with what? 7?
Yes.
Yeah? The PNP went in with the, I can't even remember the numbers now, but they came out with more. They came out with more than they went in.
Right.
The JLP went in with more actual council divisions, 130 it was.
Yes, because
they came out with less.
Yes, because at that time they were also the one with the popular vote as well.
Yes, on that score they came out with less. Yes?
Right.
And if they're going to be honest, yeah, with I had so many JLP people coming here, ministers, mayors coming here, or they're going to sweep Westmoreland.
Yes. I hear all of it. Even Mary, the current Hanover,
and not Nagosa.
Even current and with my good friend there, Mr. Morgan, say as long as he's in whatever government, that gentleman there will switch Naga with Moko.
So brethren, the thing is that you want to split hairs about number of councils, your controller, or whatever, you go and fool yourself. We're not fooling yourself. Yes? Fooling yourself. Yeah? It never go according to plan. It went badly, yeah? Off plan. Yeah?
It did.
Anyway, your time, not my time to talk. Go ahead.
No, I just want to get this from you. And I'm satisfied and I'm pleased.
Okay, sir. They must stop using and abusing me. Yeah? The two of them. I told one of my comrade friends this morning, in language I cannot use here. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Or they, you know.
Or they abuse you.
Yes, and use me when it suits them.
When it suits them. I wait to suit them.
Gonna come on for the name, man.
Hey, I am so. If I should tell a son name, we didn't call you what I see.
Exactly. Yeah.
Both of them.
Yes, both of them. Yeah?
If I should tell a son name.
Yeah, man.
You have ruddy belly.
Have a good day, sir. Time for the break.
Like a rock, I was strong as I could be. Like a rock, nothing ever got to me. Like a rock, I was something to see. Like a rock.
Total Tools Rental and Electrical Supplies is Jamaica's one-stop shop for tools and equipment rental, sales, repair, service, transportation, and parts. They almost always have it. If they don't, they will source it. Check out their pickup and delivery service and their equipment with operator for hire service. Visit their Ocherius or Crossroads branch. Follow them on social media, call or WhatsApp 876-834-5300.
Wayne, it happened again. People keep coming up to me bigging up Flow Yard and Road. One lady stopped me in the supermarket to say she loves Yard and Road because she gets both internet and mobile in one plan and how much money she saves. Then I saw this guy who told me that the internet speed is super fast.
Guy? What guy?
No, and his girlfriend. She's a blogger, so she uses the unlimited social media when she's on the road.
I knew they would love it. Told you so.
No, I told you so.
No, I told you so.
Get Flow Yard and Road, the one for all today. Visit discoverflow.co or a Flow store for more information.
Maybe it's time to explore your options. There's no harm in reviewing your mortgage arrangement and considering a better deal. CIBC Caribbean can help you narrow your search and decide. Switch your mortgage to CIBC Caribbean and enjoy a special interest rate and help towards your switching cost. Visit cibcfcib.com/inspired home for more information. Conditions apply.
Super healthy, super happy. SuperMed located in Kingston, St. Thomas, Portland, and St. Mary. The time by SuperMed family of pharmacies and Huenden Pharmacy is
13 minutes to 11.
Our phone numbers are 630-9371, 630-9372, 630-9373, 630-9374, and 618-8255.
My hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright, my walk had purpose, my steps were quick and light, and I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock, like a rock, I was strong as I could be. Like a rock, nothing ever got to me. Like a rock, I was something to see. Like a rock, and I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes.
12 minutes going up to 11. Good morning, Greg. Hello, good morning, Greg.
Good morning, Mr. Youth. Are you here?
Yes, sir.
How are you?
I'm good.
Mr. Youth, you know what I would say to the Prime Minister with how he should market NID? He should market NID as a treaty of peace and friendship. You see, I was told once that is not what you're doing. Is how you do it, and not what you say is how you say it. You say, who I believe will win the next general election is the prime minister that will be able, or the leader of either party, that will be able to convince the Jamaican people that they can restore trust within critical institutions that political assassins are currently destroying. You see, when I listen to you on a daily basis, whether I'm driving or working, all I hear and which is why I call your program, are examples of mismanagement and institutions, important institutions, that are being breached. You know, Mr. Hughes, as a concerned Jamaican, when I myself have faced that bad, it is disheartening. Let me give you a simple example of what I mean. You must have heard before, they say, some people say, he who do the same thing and expect a different result is a fool. The last time a person said that to me, I said to him, not in respect to trust. And they asked me, what do you mean? They said to me, what do you mean? And I explained, if I put my money in a...
Hello? Hello? Hello?
You're there?
Yes, I'm here, but something is wrong with your line.
Oh, yes, I know. So, for instance, if I put my money in a financial institution and that one institution fails, does that mean that any other institution will fail me and I must not trust the other institution? I don't believe so. I believe trust is a thing that sow a seed of good. And when you trust, good is expected. So I don't think it is foolish to continue trusting financial institutions. So when I explain to the person, they agree. I don't know if you would agree and other persons listening. But my point for calling you is to say this to both leaders of the both parties. What is being destroyed are important institutions that we Jamaicans have learned to trust, and we don't want to lose that. We don't want to not can depend on our title office or our courts. Because I'm going to say this to you, Mr. Hughes. I was listening to Ms. Shepherd, and she made the point that Jamaicans may not trust politicians to install or to make reparations. But you know what? The common law system established an institution to settle all claims, which is the courts. So if persons want reparations, I think the best place for us to go is the courts and put your claim before the court, and then the court can say if it's valid or not. Because it's not just to make the money available, you know. There are also impediments to say you have to prove that the system, the common law system, actually enslaves you. So with the established standard in place, we can use it. So I don't think we should create something else. And I believe that is what is wrong with Jamaica, when we have all the tools, but they are being mismanaged. So I don't have a problem with either political party, you know. Mm. I just have a problem when people try to interfere with good established standards, Mr. Hughes. Thanks for listening.
Okay, sir. Thank you. 6 minutes going up to 11. Grant, good morning.
Yes, Mr. Hughes, how are you doing today?
I'm alive and well.
Let me pull you back into a little politics, you see. I'm from St. Mary, and I listen to your program on a daily basis. And the other day in the parish council election, when the mayor said he's going to win 12 seats out of the 13, and the opposition said they're going to win 8. I want to know why the JLP think that they can win election without organization. Because I'm from Central St. Mary and we don't have a candidate here for the longest while. And we have a chairman of the Jamaica Labour Party in the parish who is MP, and the deputy general secretary is the mayor. And we don't have a caretaker of the Central St. Mary. And we don't have any organization. A matter of fact, in Central, and by extension, I don't think we have any in the parish. And you say we was going to lose 16 seats the other day. And if you ask me, we might not have any seat in a St. Mary. None in the next general election. Because nobody is on the ground. Mr. Youth, nobody, absolutely. I've been supporting the Jamaica Labour Party from 1976. I went to the United States and I spent about 27 years and I came back. Started a business, very successful business, and I'm here. I turned it over to my son. So I float around and do construction and so on and so on.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt so sick and embarrassed knowing that the people of Jamaica give me the word. 49 seats in parliament and they cannot keep it because they don't have any organization on the ground. And you cannot win election without organization, Mr. Youth. I don't know how they're going to do it.
Mm-hmm. So how long they've been without a caretaker for Central St. Mary?
Long time. From Lennon Richard, I think he's here masquerading as a caretaker. And,
what do you mean masquerading?
Because he was supposed to resign and they say he's going to resign. He don't want to seat and it's back and forth and all of that.
Uh-huh.
But we don't have a caretaker in Central.
Uh-huh. Oh.
For the longest while. So how can you go into a general election next year? And we have it vacant for the longest while and we cannot find a man to run in Central St. Mary. We lost Port Maria. The PNP actually give it to us. And we lost Port Maria division, which would be vital for us to own the capital. And we lost it the other day because of here. No organization again, Mr. Hughes.
What do you mean you don't have no organization? You have
none. Absolutely none.
You have the party chairman there. You have MP Minister Dunn there.
Mr. Hughes.
Mayor Creary there. You had, who is the other one you had there? Yeah.
We have the caucus. They have the caucus meeting. I haven't been in attendance. But I know people who attend. Doctor Dunn haven't been there for the longest while. Maybe he attend 2 times before the council election. He haven't been back there.
Oh, you mean he hasn't been back where?
He haven't been to no meeting. I'm telling you, Mr. Hughes, I'm telling you fact because I'm a part of the grown the movement in the JLP in St. Mary.
Hold on. You realize that Dunn held on to his seats.
Held on to his seat because of the councillor that he has. I don't think he held on because of him.
Mm.
He has Mayor Creary, which is he's a hardworking councillor in his division.
Yeah.
Dan Vaz is a hardworking councillor. And you is a very hard councillor in Anatabia.
Mm-hmm.
So and I think they do it all by themselves if you ask me. Robinson lost the Belfield division, didn't get no help from anybody. And it's such a disgrace. No organization, Mr. Hughes, in the parish, I would say.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't care what. I know they're going to call me and beat me up, but I don't care. Because we're at the bottom of the pit.
Mm-mm.
We're at the bottom of the pit. If we can't find a caretaker of the Central St. Mary, which they campaign on the border. Bobby Montague campaign on his border. Dr. Dunn campaign on his border. If you don't have pushback in Central, you're still in trouble because people on the borderline looking for expectation. And we have nobody in Central to push back and forth in the two
countries. So what are you saying? The leadership of the Labour Party has abandoned St. Mary?
But if you ask me, they abandoned the test, if you ask me. And like I say, I know I'm going to get beat up shortly after I know from you, but I don't care because it turns my stomach.
Oh.
We run out of everything. And not only St. Mary. Not only when I look at the overall election, Mr. Hughes, we run out of everything. We run out of even good clothing.
What do you mean?
For the people to wear.
Come on.
We went outside in good clothing. We're supposed to modernize the Jamaica Labour Party going in the next election. And if we don't do that, we're in a serious trouble.
Oh. You run out of good clothing.
Though. Yeah, we don't have anything. Nothing at all. We don't have everything.
Like what? Like you don't have what? You're talking symbolically, right?
Yes, yes.
Oh.
Symbolically.
Mm.
People work and they don't get a pay. The runners and all of that. I mean, especially in the Belfield division. I mean, you have a member of parliament who is a minister. And the Belfield division, the people that do the running and all that, they don't get a pay up to today. They're blaming the councillor who don't have a dime.
Mm-mm. Hold on for me, sir. We're up on a break. Hold on.
I will hold on, sir.
Yes.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick.
Super healthy, super happy. SuperMed located in Kingston, St. Thomas, Portland, and St. Mary. The time by SuperMed family of pharmacies and Hewenden Pharmacy is
11 o'clock.
I stay locked to the Olympics because, of course, I'm Jamaican. What you mean? Me, I have to tune into the Olympics, man. Because I'm always busy, but what? I have to know when Sherika Jackson beat Shakari.
Brother, I have to have every notification for the Olympics. I want to hear every run.
Now Sherika Jackson coming.
Every
up.
Jump.
Well, that is absolutely huge of way, Pinker.
And every fling, live.
So, take us then.
Nothing can miss me.
We're always on the move.
So while we're driving, run, Elaine, run.
Jogging. Yes. Run, Watson. Win again.
Watson is now a world champion.
Or even at work.
Quick, the race has started.
We can't miss a beat because we keep it locked
to the only station
for the Paris Olympics.
Nationwide.
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 Nationwide. 90 FM.
Nationwide, 90.1, 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9. And on YouTube at Nationwide 90 FM Live. Nationwide, the new revolution in media.
Cliff Hughes Online. Talk radio for all Jamaicans.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light, and I held firm.
Grant?
Yes, Mr. Hughes, I'm here.
Yes, so we're going to wrap up now. We have an interview coming up. So you're telling me that the Labour Party is in shambles in St. Mary. No leadership.
Yeah, we need the Prime Minister is being lied to, and I think he needs to send out a team throughout the whole island to find out on a fact-finding mission, because he's been lied to all over the place. Mm-hmm. And he thinks that things is going on. And I don't think it's good. I think the Prime Minister also dispatched some people to go on a fact-finding mission,
mm-hmm,
and report to him. As with Mr. Hughes, we're in trouble, serious trouble. And I'm a supporter of the Jamaica Labour Party since 1976. I run for the Jamaica Labour Party in the Highgate Division 1977.
And so what's your name, sir?
My name is Leon Grant, sir.
Leon Grant. Uh-huh.
Right. So I know what I'm talking about. I mean, the political, the GLP, as a local organizer for the longest while.
Mm-hmm.
All these years I went abroad and came back, and I'm still in the thing. And I'm not satisfied. Turn my stomach, Mr. Hughes,
mm-hmm,
to be honest.
I hear you.
To see what's going on. And the Prime Minister don't know. I don't think he knew.
Well, he was out there. He was out there working overtime. They had him in jail, set me up until after 2-1 morning.
Mr. Hughes.
And we now know why.
Mr. Hughes, if you're on the ground, you don't need the Prime Minister.
Mm-hmm.
If you have an organization, you don't need the Prime Minister, Mr. Hughes.
Yes.
After we win 49 seats, I almost count to see that we don't need no Prime Minister if we have an organization.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, he's said to be making and preparing to make changes. So let us see Leon Grant, all right?
Yes, sir. Me, I call my name, them know me, them up. My phone I go ring off at the hook now. But I couldn't help myself. I've been tempted to call you from the other day.
Uh-huh.
And I haven't told you half of the thing. And oh? I haven't picked up my mind totally. Yeah. I have to hold back something.
You must come back another morning, man. I have this interview I have to go do now. But you call me back.
Thank you very much, sir.
Because it ain't going to cost you and it ain't going to cost me.
I don't care. I'm maxed out now, Mr. Hughes. I'm maxed out, to be honest.
All right. Okay. All right, Leon Grant, take care of yourself. It's 5 minutes after 11. Well, the Make Your Mark group will be hosting their annual Middle Managers Leadership Conference. The conference is designed to uncover leadership insights, networking opportunities, and professional development experiences. Here to give us more information about the leadership, the Middle Managers Conference, is Principal Director, Make Your Mark Group, Dr. Jacqueline Coke Lloyd. Good morning, Dr. Coke Lloyd.
Morning, Coke. How are you? Morning, listeners.
I am good. You mean it's time again for the Middle Managers Conference?
Can you imagine? Everybody says to me, you're still at this thing after so many years, and why are you doing it?
And it's annual, right?
Yes, it is. Yes,
but it felt like it was only a week or two ago we're talking about it.
Can you imagine? Yeah. I always tell people, time flies, so you better be doing something.
Oh, so tell me about the mandate and the work of Make Your Mark Group.
We spend our time on people development, essentially. So we do individual and corporate transformation. So we spend a lot of our time with the people in the middle, actually. Mm-hmm. So the Middle Managers Conference is one of those flagship, or, you know, what we call our immersion interventions, because we believe that the managers, or those who supervise, those who lead the middle, is from the middle, are the ones who we call the sergeant majors. They make things happen in the organization. So that's part of what we do at Make Your Mark. We do global mobility, so anything to do with people coming in and out of the island, you are transferring, you're relocating, we do that as well. We do a whole gamut of human resource development, including industrial relations. We do training, coaching, anything to do with professional development and business development.
Mm-hmm. And this is the 13th staging of the conference, yes?
Correct.
And
14th. Yeah.
Oh, mm-hmm. And tell me, how has it been supported over the years?
Very well, actually, Cliff. Many organizations see it as a staple to develop their new managers, because, you know, people are always promoting from within, and so those persons are now being trained and developed. And this 2 days is a really serious immersion, because, you know, we have over 25 presenters, and these are all persons who have been there, done that, to their people. It's not an academic conference. We have a mixture of both academia, and, of course, most of our presenters are practicing entrepreneurs or leaders in their own right. So we believe it's a product that really has helped leaders and organizations in Jamaica.
Yeah. And what are the issues that you're going to cover this year, Mrs. Coke-Lloyd?
Mm. We have so many, because if the theme speaks to championing change, adaptability, and strategy. So we recognize
that
there are so many.
Repeat that for us, the theme?
Sorry, it's championing change, adaptability, and strategy.
Uh-huh.
Because you recognize the issues around talent. It's not only Jamaica, it's a worldwide issue. So it therefore means those persons in the middle are being called on to do a lot more. People are leaving organizations without notice. So the person in the middle has to be reporting up, managing for down, managing their own space. So, you know, the conference will speak to strategy, crisis management, just managing your peers, how does a middle manager remain authentic. We're talking about professional development, moving into a space, owning that space, customer service, how do you sell a vision, how do you sell the strategy, how do you make tough decisions, how do you tell your peers or your team members about a decision you don't necessarily agree with.
Mm-hmm.
It happens all the time that a middle manager is given a mandate. Well, they don't agree with it. But how do they communicate that as a leader and also a team member?
Mm-hmm.
So we're looking at a number of areas. Transformational leadership. How do you manage the several generations in one? I had a manager last year. He came up of our sessions. He said he manages mostly women. He's a young manager. And he did not know how to deal with this lady who was going through menopause. It's simple things like that. He's a young man in his 30s. He now is asked to supervise. And ladies, most of the ladies are in the workforce. How does he do that? So we're also having a session just for men and a session just for women. Because we find these two sessions are so important, because men are few. You only have, 50% in the workforce or in management are men now, are male. So they have a different set of issues to deal with if you're managing mostly women, and they don't know. And they have their own personal matters to deal with. So that session, we believe those two sessions are important, just looking at how they manage issues inside and outside the workplace.
But hold on there now, Dr. Cokelyd. You said something a while ago that has sent out something in my head.
Yes, sir.
Women going through menopause
pose
different challenges at the workplace?
Of course. Menopause is a totally different ballgame. A lady now has to,
I know it poses all kinds of challenges, but I've never seen it in the context of these being demonstrated at the workplace. And as a manager of women, menopausal women, you have to take this into consideration. When you said it, it hit me.
Yes, and a lot of people don't realize that, Cliff. Women, that's why, as I say, men, ought to be taking care of women in such a different way. Because a woman is working, she's raising children, she's studying, she's going through life changes that have nothing, it's just a part of life. But she has to function. And she's also being evaluated at the workplace, despite all of these changes in her life. Mm-hmm. She's hot and cold in the same 10-minute space. Her brain is foggy in the same 10-minute space, but she's expected to function. Mm-hmm. And there's nothing much she can do about it because it's part of life.
Mm. So, those of us who are in management, we need to understand that menopausal women ought to, what is the word I'm looking for, Dr. Lloyd, help me.
The first thing I think managers need to do is learn about these things that affect their team members, whether it's menopause, whether it's, what does it mean? What do you need to do? If the lady said, I'm really just feeling very bad today, is the temperature in the room good enough for her? Do you need to be checking her ACs more often because she needs to be cool? For her to function.
Yeah.
So, we need to read up more, Cliff. I believe our managers need to be more aware of all the life issues. It's not only about the work and the job. It's about who their people are, what stages are their people at. A 20-year-old, what does it mean for a 20-year-old versus a 40 or a 60? They're all different beings that you have to lead, you have to manage, you have to motivate, and you have to help them to perform better, because their shareholders and your executives are expecting you to manage these persons or to lead, to engage them in a meaningful way so that they can produce.
Yeah.
So you can't help people or lead people if you don't know anything about their life and who they are.
So the conference, tell me about the details of people who are interested. How can they be registered and get on board, sign up, that kind of thing?
Okay, they can go straight to our website, www.makeyourmarkgroup.com. They can call our offices at 978-600-122. And we're also on all the major platforms, whether it's LinkedIn, Facebook. So they can always check all of those areas and be able to access the information. It's May 1-2 at the Jamaica Pegasus and online as well. So there are options that they can look at. But we do like the on-site option because you get to network, you meet people, you're part of a space, people you don't forget, friendships you make, and you're learning opportunities that will stay with you for life as a growing leader.
All right. Well, all the best with it. Again, Dr. Cokelyd, and you give me work to go do now.
Thank you so much, Cliff. It's always a pleasure.
Good. That's Dr. Jacqueline Cokelyd. She is Principal Director of the Make Your Mark group. And it's their middle managers conference again on for May 1 and 2 at the Pegasus Hotel. All right, this is Cliff Hughes online.
What I felt was right, like a rock. Like a rock.
Clearing personal non-commercial shipments at the port? Avoid the wait. Request a contactless clearance through your agent today. It's more efficient. It's secure. The time by the Jamaica Customs Agency is
15 minutes after 11.
Welcome, Deluxe. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
When you're good, you're just good.
Hey! Add the national flavor. You're gonna want to buy this bag.
So good. It's just so good.
Welcome Deluxe. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
National Baking Company. Just so, so good.
Wayne, it happened again. People keep coming up to me bigging up Flow Yard and Road. One lady stopped me in the supermarket to say she loves Yard and Road because she gets both internet and mobile in one plan and how much money she saves. Then I saw this guy who told me that the internet speed is super fast.
Guy? What guy?
No, and his girlfriend. She's a blogger, so she uses the unlimited social media when she's on the road.
I knew they would love it. Told you so.
No, I told you so.
No, I told you so.
Get Flow Yard and Road, the one for all today. Visit discoverflow.co or a Flow store for more information.
Studying overseas? Contact
our phone numbers are 630-9371, 630-9372, 630-9373, 630-9374, and 618-8255.
Hands were steady, my eyes were clear and bright.
It is 17 minutes after 11 o'clock, and following the call from that Labourite, Leon Grant, yes, saying that the Labour Party leadership has abandoned the parish of St. Mary, who do we have but the former mayor of Port Maria? Yes, Mayor Richard Creary. Good morning, former mayor. Good morning.
Morning, Mr. Hughes.
How are you?
I am fine, you know, but
you have recovered? Have you recovered? Have you recovered?
There's nothing to recover from, you know, Mr. Hughes.
Yes, weren't all surprised. You weren't all surprised and shocked that you had lost a parish that you were expected to win comfortably?
No, I am surprised that we lost some of the divisions that we lost. And had we not lost those, we would have won St. Mary comfortably, as I have said. But I won't go into the details as to why we would have lost, and I won't name any division. But I still stand by the fact that we could and should have won St. Mary comfortably.
But why you didn't, though?
What's that?
Why didn't you?
As I say, I won't go into those details.
That's no, sir, you can't come here. You can't come here to respond to Mr. Grant. Are you not prepared to answer that question?
No, man, I will respond. Remember, I asked to come and respond, so I will respond. But okay. I'm responding now to your question.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So, as I said, there are certain divisions that we should not have lost. And had things gone differently, we would have won them and won comfortably. But that, as I said, I won't go into those details. That is internal party matters for us to discuss and come up with the plans and the strategy.
If you don't want to go into the
overturn it for the general election.
If you don't want to go into the details, yes, speak to us generally. For example, why did you lose, yes, the overall control of the divisions? We know it comes down to divisions. But at the end of the day, why did you, for example, lose Gale?
And as I said, Mr. Hughes, those are matters for us to deal with internally. I will not, on the public radio like Mr. Grant, say certain things. But I'd like to respond.
Was it because the leadership of the parish was disconnected? Was it because of a failure of government policies, initiatives, to deal with the concerns of the residents of St. Mary? What was it due to?
Mr. Hughes, let me take you back in history just a little bit. In 1998 to 2003, there was one JLP representative in the parish of St. Mary. or a gentleman by the name of Bobby Montague, who was the councillor for Carronall. They had, the PNP had 3 MPs and 12 of the 13 parish council divisions. So that is the point we're coming. And if I go back a little further, in 1980, when I was 10 years old, when we won 51 seats, St. Mary still had 2 PNP MPs, when Westmoreland had none. And I challenge anyone that St. Mary is a far greater PNP parish than any other in Jamaica. We turned that in 2003 by winning 8 of the 5 divisions. 2007, we increased again, I think it was to 10, right? We lost in 2012, 8-5, right? We won again in 2016, 10-3. And now we have lost 7-6. Your poll, Mr. Hughes, had us, I think, somewhere 26 points behind the PNP just weeks before the election. So if that poll had held, we should have gotten a trouncing from the PNP. We lost marginally 7-6. Although I still say we should not have lost had certain things that were to be done were done. But I won't go into those details. So I have set the history. St. Mary is a PNP parish.
But at
we
the end
have
of the...
turned it off late, mm-hmm. and we plan to, in the next general election, based on the work that we will be doing, I am confident that we will retain the 2 seats we have in St. Mary, being Western and Southeast.
And based on the actual votes on February 26, how many of those 2 seats you would have retained?
I have not checked the figures. Anecdotally, I have heard that we would have retained Southeast. We might have marginally lost Western St. Mary.
Mm-hmm. But
there's
one other point, Mr. Mayor, and I appreciate the political history because it's very important that context be provided. And I wouldn't challenge the history of you as you have outlined it. I recall very clearly when the entire country was going green, on October 30, 1980, the PNP was holding on with Horace Clark in Central St. Mary. Yes, it has never gone to the JLP.
And Terry Gillette.
Terry Gillette in Western St. Mary, which is a seat now occupied by the chairman of the JLP. Yes? But the point raised by Mr. Grant, though, he said to me in that call, that listen, the leadership of the party has abandoned the parish, that you have all not been doing the work in the parish.
Just let me finish.
And he said that you're all lying to the Prime Minister. Yes, and the Prime Minister needs to send out an independent person to double check what you're all doing, because if you were all working, you wouldn't be in the position you're in this morning. How you respond to that?
And that is exactly what I call to respond to, because Mr. Grant is painting doom and gloom as if the Jamaica Labour Party is finished in St. Mary. And that is why I went into the history and also pointed out that we have lost 7-6. It is not a trouncing that we have gotten from the PNP. Right? So, you know, I like to set the context. There is some truth to what Mr. Grant has said in terms of the Jamaica Labour Party should have done better. There are individual divisions that candidates took certain decisions that at the end of the day, I am sure they are now looking back to say, had I done things differently, I would have remained or I would have been a councillor today. Right? There are other divisions that, you know, greater assistance could have been given, and I won't say from where, right, but greater assistance could have been given. So I am still of the view that we should have won had things been done slightly differently. Mm-hmm. However, there is no doom and gloom that St. Mary is, you know, we have no chance of winning St. Mary. We lost 7-6, and I am confident we'll retain the 2 constituencies we have. There is work to be done, Mr. Hughes, right? The PNP was more resurgent in the last election. That is obvious.
Mm-hmm.
In 2016 and 2020, we faced a dormant PNP. The PNP was more resurgent. I believe that a lot of, and I'm not speaking specifically now to St. Mary, but I believe there was a level of overconfidence by a number of candidates.
Labourites.
A number of members of parliament, because this was, we ran, I think the GLP ran this election as a local government election, whereas the PNP ran it as a general election. Right? And they, I think they put out far greater effort in the election than we did. Hindsight is 2020 vision. Right?
And but also, I detected as well, Mayor Kerry, that the GLP organization was not in the best of condition. That the organization that you need to respond, to get your voters out on the day, to do the kinds of tallies at 12 o'clock, 2 o'clock, 4 o'clock, yes? That machine somehow wasn't there on February 26th.
I wouldn't say it was not there, but I I'll go back to the point. We were running a typical local government, candidate to candidate. You know, we think our candidate is superior. We have done, you know, work on the ground. For example, if there was a councillor, the councillor has done so much work. You know, and I think we thought that would have carried us home. And we ran a local government election. On the other hand, the PNP ran, what now in hindsight you will see, the PNP had far more funds on the ground than us. I think they had a lot of the operatives of the PNP that were dormant for some time. And I listen to your programs, I hear your callers. There were former ministers walking with walking stick out there on election day, mobilizing voters.
Yes, in places like Manchester, Mandeville, yes.
Yeah, it happened all over Jamaica. You had people coming from overseas, Mister. I've never seen so many PNP operatives flying from overseas for an election. They took the election far more seriously than us. Let us call us. I am willing to call a spade a spade where that is concerned. I won't go into some of the other details, as I said, as to, you know, these are things that we have to have discussions on internally.
But a question for you.
Discussions have started.
A question for you as a political operative. You're an experienced man at the politics. Yes? Can the Labour Party turn it around from here on? Or is it that the momentum is such now that it's almost impossible to turn it around?
I am of the view, Mr. Hughes, that there is enough time to turn it around. As I said, what has happened in this local government election, it is a wake-up call for the Jamaica Labour Party. Had we not gotten this wake-up call, we would have lulled ourselves into believing that we would have just naturally won the general election. Having gotten this wake-up call, I think a lot of things are going to be done differently. And we have, I believe, there is enough time that if we do these things differently, then we will win. I have said, Mr. Hughes, all right, for example, I was the one who planned the leader's tour to St. Mary along with the party chairman. If you notice, the leader came nowhere in my division. I don't need the leader for me to win my division. I won comfortable by 400 votes, right? So I don't need a leader. And I believe that as politicians, some of us believe, right? I have always said this, Mr. Hughes, I don't know if I've said it to you. People, with being a representative, what people want more with you than anything else is a relationship. They want to be able to take up their phone and call you and get you. They want to be able to see you in their community. If they have a problem, they should be able to reach out to you. If you can't even solve the problem, you can direct them somewhere to solve it. Right? A lot of us as politicians, we neglect the people. And then we expect to go back 3 months or 6 months before an election.
Yes.
Right? And I think a little of that was what the level of overconfidence that you're going to win anyway. Right? And I think a lot of, and it happens on both sides, you know, it's not a GLP phenomenon. It happens on both sides. We're with politicians.
And when you're in office, people, when you're in office for 8 years, you get complacent. You start to become disconnected.
I've never got complacent in my division. Right? And nothing misses me.
I'm not talking about you. You win. So it's not about you now. I'm talking about so many others of your parliamentary and local colleagues. Yes,
I agree with you. And you see, this, as I said, what I am saying to you now is something I preach daily.
Mm-hmm.
But you can, the saying is, you can lead a horse to the water, you can't make them drink.
So true, so true.
And I have, what I am saying to you, I've said to every politician on every platform, every occasion, but people, I don't know, they probably don't take it seriously. Mm-hmm. They think there's an easier way out.
Mm-hmm.
Eh? Politics is about serving people.
Can you hold on for me? Can you
all of their problems.
Can you hold on for me, Mayor Crary? Hold on for me, please. We're up on a break.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light.
Is your money idling when it could be thriving? With CIBC Caribbean's fixed deposit offering, you can take charge of your cash. With 50,000 Jamaican to start, choose terms from 30 days to 2 years. Lock in your funds and enjoy premium rates guaranteed to grow your wealth. Whether you're eyeing short or long-term gains, our fixed deposit accounts puts you firmly in control of your money. Now is the time to open a CIBC fixed deposit account and start earning more today. CIBC, ambitions made real.
A mother's journey of love shared from generation to generation gives her the ultimate relaxation and escape to Adam and Eve Day Spa and Salon for a mommy-made new experience. Book now at www.adamandevespaja.com. Purchase gift certificates or call 876-754-6017. Get mom the perfect gift of love. This Mother's Day, let Team Adam and Eve take her on a spa journey. She deserves it.
Don't miss out on the Homeowners Expo at IREC 2024. Join us from Friday, April 19 to Saturday, April 20 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Come and experience everything for your home. The latest in smart technologies and innovative solutions and vibrant displays with live demos. There's something for everyone. Kids Corner, exciting entertainment and amazing prizes. Admission is free. Visit IREC.realtorsjamaica.org. See you there.
Good health starts with proper hydration. Hydrate your body with Idrate. Idrate is purified natural water from rocks 110 feet below the ground. You have never tasted water so great, yet so affordable. Yes, taste and experience it for yourself. Water at its best. Idrate. Available also as purified alkaline water and ultra-purified distilled water. Bottled by LLNSCS Limited, a subsidiary of Max Pharmaceuticals. Call 876-983-6466.
Cliff Hughes Online. Talk radio for all Jamaicans.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear.
All right, we're back with the former mayor of Port Maria, Richard Crary, looking at the performance of the governing Jamaica Labour Party in the February 26 local government elections. And the call was precipitated by a Labourite who identified himself as a Leon Grant in St. Mary. And Mayor Crary is, talking with me about what really happened on the election and being guarded, being a good party man, not giving away too much details. But so far, Mayor Crary? Mayor Crary? Yes. So we were at the point of turning it around. Yes? You have time. The elections are not constitutionally due until September next year. So you have what, 15, 16 months, yes, a week in politics. I like to remind my listeners the famous saying of Sir Harold Wilson, yes, a week in politics is a long, long time. You never know. So, Mayor Crary, but the Labour Party seemed to have a problem, a number of problems. It seems to have grown fat and old in government, not paying enough attention to the party machine and the base of the party. And as I said yesterday and this morning, or was it yesterday morning, it's as if I'm seeing history repeating itself. And I make reference to March 2001, the by-election up in Northeast St. Anne, the JLP's Shahine Robinson of blessed memory, and Carol Jackson in that by-election, when the two parties went at it, full throttle, yes, and the JLP and Shahine won. And that marked the beginning of the return from the political wilderness of the Jamaica Labour Party. Well, what did P.J. Patterson do? He was a prime minister and PNP president at the time. He took out Maxine Henry Wilson and Paul Roberts and sent them into the field from the cabinet. He took them from the cabinet and said, go rebuild 89 Old Hope Road and the party organization. What happened by October 2002? Yes, the PNP scraped home with 34 of the seats, 34-26. And I'm wondering if that's what we're seeing again in terms of the politics. What say you?
Well, Mr. Hughes, I'm sure you would have known that. I heard it on your station that there are changes to come. And
but you know that. You never have to hear it on nationwide. Right, but you know that.
Why I said it that way is because you are aware as well. So let us wait and see what those changes will be.
No. You're not
but
going
there
to...
will definitely
Richard,
be some changes.
Mayor.
That will have, yes?
Mayor. And I'm not taking liberty.
I'm not the mayor again. I'm not upset the current mayor.
Mr. Crary, you know you are well in the belly of the JLP. You don't hear what we hear, so change is coming.
But Mr. Hughes, you know that you can't draw me out to tell your Labour Party business on here. You know that.
But I'm not drawing
you
out.
So you will have to await the changes.
Yes, we will have to await. But
maybe if you want, we can have the conversation thereafter.
But you know.
Or you can have the conversation at a higher pay grade. Maybe you'd want to speak to the leader or the GenSec or someone like that.
But Mr. Crary, yes, aren't you aware that there is talk in the Labour Party that, listen, the leader has been making calls. He has been doing certain things to make the changes that must come. Aren't you aware of that?
So, Mr. Hughes, as I said before, can we await those changes and have the discussion? I know it is something that sells. So everybody wants to talk about cabinet reshuffle, this, that, the other. It's just a short time, Mr. Hughes. Just have a little patience, please. Let's not discuss.
Go on, Richard.
Let's get back to what Mr. Grant.
Go on,
said.
Richard. Go on. Yes.
Yes, I want to deal with another issue that Mr. Grant raised. He says there is no caretaker in Central St. Mary, which is a fact. But we have two aspirants, and it is something that the party will be dealing with in short order as to which one of the two aspirants will lead us into the general election. There's a lot of enthusiasm surrounding the two aspirants, probably more so one than the other. But as I'm trying to say, the Labour Party is not dead in St. Mary. The Labour Party has, Mr. Grant mentioned, the caucus meeting. Now, we have a very active caucus where all of us sit around a table and we discuss matters pertaining to politics in St. Mary. This started, by the way, Mr. Hughes, in 2002. When we lost the general election in October, I believe it was, and we started this caucus, one Bobby Montague again, started a caucus, invited us. That is how he convinced me, he convinced my brother first to run the Castleton division. And then they both convinced me by the January to run the Richmond division. And the rest is history. So we have been meeting from as far back as November 2002. And we have continued up until now. That is why Mr. Grant can mention about a caucus.
So let me
he was a member of that caucus, and he has not been attending caucus meetings.
Oh?
But he should not be on the radio, saying certain things that he's saying. But that we know that is how. We know him as Will, When you hear Leon Grant, nobody don't know who name so. When you hear Will, everybody know who Will is.
So who are the two aspirants for Central St. Mary?
Again, I will not go into those details, Mr. Hughes. When the time comes and one is selected, I'm sure maybe you can have him on your program and have an interview.
Oh.
But the people of Central St. Mary are aware of the two aspirants, and it is something that we are dealing with. And we are confident, as I said, it is a resurgent PNP, but we are still confident that we'll retain the two seats that we have, and that we have a very good chance in getting Central St. Mary as well.
You did say that the loss for the JLP in St. Mary was narrow, 7-6, yes? Did you win the popular vote in the parish, or they won the popular vote in the parish?
I don't know, I don't have the facts, but I would almost say I'm pretty sure they would have won the popular vote as well.
Okay.
One of the dynamics about Central St. Mary, you know, and to a lesser extent, Arakabessa, we have, you know, somewhat changed that over time. But Central Highgate Division can give the PNP, you know, a 1,000 or a 1,500 lead over the Jamaica Labour Party, right? So it is one of those divisions that, you know, has that effect. Mm-hmm. But we those two aspirants, let me leave it at that, they are aware of the fact that if for us to win Central St. Mary, we are going to have to put a little bit more focus on Highgate. And it is something that we have, you know, over the years, because it is such a strong PNP division, I wouldn't say we have neglected it, but we need to do more work in the Highgate division.
And
but there was a time when we even won 3 of the 4 council divisions in Central St. Mary, and I still believe we lost the popular vote on that, and in terms of Central St. Mary. But just because of the majority of Highgate.
But the PNP has, of course, the incumbent MP there now, Dr. Morris Guy, who has indicated that he won't be seeking re-election. And the PNP have elected and put in place their successor to Morris Guy more than a year ago. What are you waiting on?
We will deal with our situation in short order, and it is for Dr. Guy, a friend of mine. He knew he one of the reasons I believe he's leaving Central St. Mary. He only was won it the last time by, I think, a little over 400 votes. He normally wins by 2,000, 3,000.
Mm-hmm.
We are of the view that the candidate who has replaced him, you know, we think it is an ideal time for the Jamaica Labour Party to win Central St. Mary.
Oh.
So we are going to put in all the effort, Mr. Hughes. We are going to put in the candidate of the people's choice, and we will be working in Central St. Mary. So I don't want anybody to believe that the GLP is dead in St. Mary. We lost narrowly, 7-6, and we are alive and well and vibrant. In St. Mary, and we will hold St. Mary.
In the shortly after the local elections, you were here with me, and you told me about your disappointment in the by-vote mentality, the sell-vote mentality. And you did say to me that you were seriously thinking of leaving the politics. Have you made a decision?
No, Mr. You know, this is that misunderstanding. Even in my own division, I have gone and people say, oh, you're resigning. That's not what I actually said, you know, Mr. Hill. What I said is, I will, and I've told people this even before that interview, I'll be doing at least another 10 years. But what I said to you on the day is that when I am leaving probably at the opportune time, because politics is changing, and what is happening, each election becomes harder than the one before, right? So when I'm leaving in 10 years' time, it probably will be the best time to leave, because
you didn't say 10 years,
I'm sure
Mr.
the
Mayor.
Next election will be harder than this one, and the one after that will even be harder still.
But you didn't say 10 years, though.
What's that?
You didn't say 10 years. You didn't say that at all.
Well,
if you had put that time, I didn't
say I was leaving. No,
no.
But as I say, something I have said to persons, even within my division and other persons, that I don't plan to stay in politics till my back bend. Right? Retirement age is 65. I am now 54 years old. So 10, 11 years is a reasonable time for me.
Yes.
To call it a day.
You have been a counselor for how many years now?
21 years now, Mr. Hughes.
21 years.
From 2003.
And then
I took a division that was controlled by the People's National Party. And the People's National Party, through their best efforts, will not retain that, will not take back that division. And not only when I leave, because I'm going to ensure, when I leave, I don't mean I'm leaving. The people in Richmond now, Mr. Hughes, is like family to me. Right? And I can't leave and just leave.
So
I will still have to be there with them.
Hold on, Mr. Mayor. Let me ask you a question, man. You're just rattling, you know. So, you're 54. Yes, you have another 10 years to go. You have been councillor for 21 years. You have been mayor for how long?
Roughly 12 or 13 out
Good.
Of that 21.
So therefore, me know you're an ambitious young man. You're not looking to step it up to the parliamentary level?
Absolutely not, Mr. Hughes. I did that once in, I don't know if you forgot, in 2011. When, again, I didn't want to do it. And I, you know, at the time, I was told, by at the short notice, you have the best opportunity. At that time, my children were much younger, and it was the hardest decision I have ever made in my life to say, yes, okay, I will do it. And I believe it was divine intervention why I didn't win, because I really didn't want to be a member of parliament. Right? And
that was when you ran in.
Everything that happens in my life is
you ran in Southeast.
By the Almighty.
You ran in Southeast.
Yes, in 2011. Yeah. I lost by, I think, about 400 votes to Dr. Winston Green.
Yes, yes.
But it's something that I have not regretted, because I did not want to be a parliamentarian. I still don't. People keep asking me,
why?
You don't want a seat? No, absolutely not.
Why? Why you don't want to be a parliamentarian?
I am, for one, as I said earlier, those people in Richmond are like family to me, right? So, all right, if running in Southeast Richmond would have been a part of it. So, hence the reason I would never even consider running on another seat anywhere. If Desmond called me tomorrow morning and said, come and take West Kings, I tell him thanks, but no thanks. Right? So, I did it at that time, as I said, based on those reasons. But it is not something I want to do. I quite like the fact of that family relationship we have in Richmond, where I know nearly everybody. Some of the people voting for me now, I knew them when they were in their mother's stomach, right? So I am quite comfortable there. I am comfortable at the local government level. I believe that is where service is, at the local level, right? I believe I have been able to make a lot of changes to Richmond, and not only to Richmond, but to St. Mary, being chairman of the corporation as well, right? And that is where I want to serve, Mr. Hughes, for the next 10 years, if it happens that I become chairman again, I will continue to work for my parish at that level. But if I don't become chairman again, I am quite happy serving the people of the Richmond Division until I decide to retire.
Richard Carey is a councillor for the Richmond Division of the St. Mary Municipal Corporation. He's vowing that the Labour Party will be back in St. Mary. Yes, time will tell. Thank you so much, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you very much, Mr. It was always a pleasure speaking to you.
Same here. Good.
All right. Bye.
Good, good, good. Time for the break.
My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock.
Furniture Land at 112 Conson Spring Road is Jamaica's premier furniture retailer when searching for stylish and elegant pieces for your home. The time by Furniture Land is
12 minutes to noon.
Whether it's a heartfelt eulogy, an inspiring tribute, or a remembrance, place your ads in the Life Tribute section of the Jamaica Observer to remember the extraordinary individuals who have left their mark on this world. The Life Tribute section allows you to share stories, commemorate your loved ones, and keep their memory alive. Find solace in the power of remembrance. Together, we can keep their spirit alive. Book with the Jamaica Observer today. Contact 876-936-9504 for more details.
Celebrate 25 years with IQ Optical, your trusted eyewear provider. Enjoy 25% off your prescription eyewear and sunglasses, April 9th to 20th. Book your appointment or take your prescription to IQ Optical, New Kingston, Meta Park, or Draxall. Conditions apply.
When I grow up, I'm going to be a famous gamer with viral videos all over the internet. I'm going to be rich. Good thing I already know how to take care of my money since Mommy got me this SureStart account.
Open a CIBC Caribbean SureStart account for your kids and give them a head start on financial smarts with a $1,200 sign-up bonus from us. We believe in their dreams as much as you do, so let's get them going together. Start young, start strong with SureStart from CIBC.
Millennium Properties Sales and Services, a real estate agent in Jamaica dedicated to providing the highest standard of professional and ethical services to all parties involved to fulfill your real estate needs. At Millennium, they take pride in their experienced sales team. They are a cadre of professionals with a reputation for excellent customer service that remains unsurpassed. Visit their website at www.millenniumpropertiesalesandservices.com. Telephone 876-906-2538-9. Millennium Properties Sales and Services. Call them any day, anytime.
The Olympic Games 2024 live from Paris in France, exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
The Jamaican star shines bright once again.
Live here halfway through the Olympic finals.
This summer, Nationwide 90 FM is coming in hot.
Jamaica to the blocks!
Nationwide 90 FM will be blazing as we bring you the games of the 33rd Olympiad live from the French capital, Paris. 16 fantastic days of competition in 41 sports.
Noblyn Williams-Mills coming, the glory flapping, her arms are waving, and Noblyn Williams-Mills coming through for Jamaica's gold.
The station will bring you analysis and live coverage from the opening day of competition, Friday, July 26th, to the very last day of action on Sunday, August 11th.
And some parchment! Let's go! Oh, what a run!
Everything and anything Paris Olympic Games 2024 can be heard right here on Nationwide 90 FM.
It is a glittering gold for Sharika Jackson, and how they will celebrate that back in Jamaica.
We'll capture the spirit of athleticism. We'll narrate the Olympic fever, define thrilling moments, and report on the blood, sweat, and tears of the world's greatest athletes. Nationwide 90 FM is going to the Paris Olympic Games, and we're taking you with us. Tune into Nationwide 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9 for live updates and commentary. We'll be giving the listeners a front row seat to witness excitement, triumph, and memories.
And I think it was a clean sweep for the Jamaicans.
Stay tuned to Nationwide 90 FM 24/7. Experience the Paris Olympic Games 2024 right here on the Revolution in Media, Nationwide 90 FM, your Olympic Center. Exclusively on Nationwide 90 FM.
Our phone numbers are 630-9371, 630-9372, 630-9373, 630-9374, and 618-8255.
Listen, there's a situation in a part of Westmoreland that has been brought to our attention. Yes? An ostrich, yes, has apparently escaped and causing some amount of interest. Put it up for me now. Let me show you what someone just sent, shared with us from Westmoreland. It's not a new video. No, it's not. Okay. Ah, dear. Anyway, this ostrich apparently escaped some time ago in Westmoreland, and of course all of us have phones with cameras now. So there is an ostrich going on its merry way along the roadway. Can be quite an imposing figure. Yes, quite imposing. Yeah. So I don't know where in Westmoreland is this. Yes. If you know where in Westmoreland is that, let me know. Yeah. But you don't want to get on the wrong side of an ostrich. Anyway, who do we have on the line? Andrew. Andrew? Which Andrew? Good morning.
Morning, Mr. Hughes.
Good morning.
The last time we spoke was about 6 months ago, and you said you were going to call me. I left my number with the producer, but I'm still waiting. Good thing I was only listening with one ear.
Oh, Lord. Sorry about that, sir.
But, Mr. Hughes, she has my number now. I know she's listening, and I have two things I want to talk to you about.
Mm-hmm.
And I am going to ask you again, please. I am actually begging you to just, I don't want more than 2 minutes. Just call me.
Oh.
Please.
Oh.
It is about St. Mary as well. 3 is a lucky number, you know, and it's kind of funny, or probably I should use another word, that your last 3 callers, including myself, are from St. Mary.
Uh-huh.
But
now, you know, St. Mary is a parish dear to my heart, you know.
I know that's where your mother is from.
Yes.
And that's one of the reasons why, you know, I want to talk to you as well.
Okay.
Yes, so now that I said that, I hope you will call me.
All right, sir. St. Mary,
she has my number.
right.
But two things quickly, very quickly. I am currently at St. Anthony Hospital. And I want to pick up the staff at St. Anthony Hospital. My mother is almost 90 years old now.
Mm-hmm.
And so I have to visit these places to get medication for her through the NHS.
Mm-hmm.
And I am telling you, I called you the last time I went to Anatobe. And the service was good, but I'm telling you, the service at St. Andrew Hospital is the best I've seen yet. I thought Anatobe was good,
mm-hmm.
but this is excellent.
Oh.
I even at St. Andrew, I even told the pharmacist a while ago that I'm going to call you. In fact, I was holding from before I reached the window.
Mm-hmm.
And I told her I'm holding. So she should tell everybody in the hospital that I am going to be on the radio to pick up St. Andrew Hospital.
What about their service has impressed you, sir?
If they said they're going to serve you in 50 minutes, they are going to serve you in 40 minutes.
Uh-huh.
Or in a shorter time,
uh-huh.
to cut a long story short.
Yes.
And not only that, my grandmother used to call the word C-O-U-R-T-E-O-U-S, coaches.
Yes.
They're very coaches.
Uh-huh.
Very, very courteous. No matter what you do, you can't draw them out.
Oh, that's good.
It's very, you know, when people do bad, you know, we call and
true.
Cost them. So mm-hmm. when they do good, we call and say they do good too.
That's true. So I want to big up the staff at the St. Anne's Bay Hospital. Yeah? This caller, this user, very impressed with the quality of the work you do, the customer service there at St. Anne's Bay. And that's good to know. Yes, to all of you there, big up on yourself.
But my main reason for calling you is also to big up the EOJ.
Uh-huh.
I called you in 2020, December 2020, about the EOJ not making payment for the September 2020 election to the election day workers.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Hughes, you know, in less than a month this time, the EOJ start making the payment.
Mm-hmm. That's
almost everybody, almost, not everybody, but almost everybody has been paid now. You know? And it's like 6 weeks.
Uh-huh.
So I really, really want to pick up the EOJ as well.
Ah.
I am somebody, I say it already, I'm going to say it again, when there is bad, you have people just calling and talking about the bad. But we can talk about the good too.
Very well.
The EOJ was very good this time as far as making restitution, if I can use that word,
uh-huh.
to their workers is concerned. And we want to big them up. Big up
right,
Glasspool Brown and everybody else.
All right, sir. And I'm going to give you a call.
All right. Thank you very much.
Good.
All the best.
Good. And so we're going to leave it for the morning session. We're going to make way now for the world at noon. We'll be back at 12:30.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock. Like a rock, I was strong as I could be. Like a rock, nothing ever got to me. Like a rock, I was something to see. Like a rock, and I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all hustlers and their schemes. I stood proud, I stood tall, high above it all. I still believed in my dreams. Thank you.
if it's news, it's got to be Nationwide 90 FM. You're listening to Nationwide 90 FM. The time is
12 o'clock.
It's credible and factual. The world at noon on Nationwide 90 FM.
A very good afternoon to you. I'm Tawna Thomas. Coming up in the Nationwide World at Noon for this afternoon, Tuesday, April 16, 2024. Police say there's nothing yet to confirm reports that human remains were found in a shallow grave in a part of the corporate area called Bowtie Land. Businessman Howard Mitchell wants Juliet Holness to be the next Minister of Works amid talks of a cabinet reshuffle. The Minister of Digital Transformation dismisses claims made about the NIDS program as myths and lies. Firefighters injured after shocking encounter with illegal electricity connection. In regional news, Bogota enforces raft of water restrictions amid worsening dry spell. International news, British lawmakers to vote on landmark smoking ban. And in sports, Cavaliers technical director happy to avoid JPL quarterfinals. The details after the break.
The Midday News is brought to you by Total Tools. We almost always have it.
Maybe it's time to explore your options. There's no harm in reviewing your mortgage arrangement and considering a better deal. CIBC Caribbean can help you narrow your search and decide. Switch your mortgage to CIBC Caribbean and enjoy a special interest rate and help towards your switching cost. Visit CIBCFCIB.com/inspired home for more information. Conditions apply.
Now to the details. Commanding officer for the St. Andrews South Police Division, Superintendent Damian Manderson, says he cannot confirm reports that human remains were found in a shallow grave in the community of Bowtie Land, located off Spanish Town Road in Kingston. Speaking with our news team a short while ago, Superintendent Manderson confirmed that the police were led to an area of the community as part of an investigation into missing persons.
As at last evening, that's on the 15th, some joint investigations between ourselves, Kingston and Kingston West, would have led us to a section of approach between that open space between Bowtie Island and Greenwich Farm, where that investigation being ongoing, we had discovered an area that we believe is of interest and require added work to be done, both in terms of scenes of crime based upon the investigation is pointing. We would have held that area overnight and into this morning. He is currently there, and the report to me up to a few minutes ago is that there is no confirmation that what is being seen is human remains. And I repeat that, and I'm speaking to you at this point at 11:22 a.m. There is no confirmation of any human remains being found in a shallow grave.
Superintendent Damian Manderson, commanding officer for the St. Andrews South Police Division. Police Commissioner Dr. Kevin Blake says the security forces will do all it can to capture the coward who shot and killed Constable Ricardo Fairclough in St. Anne's Bay on Monday evening. Constable Fairclough is the first policeman to be slain since the start of the year. He was killed after intervening in an attack on a 24-year-old female vendor. The incident occurred about 8:30 p.m. on Bravo Street in the vicinity of a popular supermarket. Commissioner Blake has sent condolences to the family of the slain policeman.
Kindly join me in expressing condolences to SSP Powell and his team in St. Anne for the loss of one of our valued officers, Constable Ricardo Fairclough. He was shot and killed by a coward who has no contribution to make to society. While we cannot bring back Constable Fairclough, we owe it to his family, friends, and colleagues to ensure that our response is swift and strong. Let our response send a clear message to those who may want to contemplate violence against us that it is not wise. May his blessed soul rest in peace.
Dr. Kevin Blake, Police Commissioner. Prominent businessman Howard Mitchell says Prime Minister Andrew Holness should consider appointing the MP for East Rural St. Andrew, Juliet Holness, to the post of Minister of Works. This amid speculation that Prime Minister Andrew Holness is about to shuffle his cabinet.
I do recognize that there is at least one cabinet position that must be filled, and that is to replace Everald Warmington. And it possibly could be an opportunity for the Prime Minister to solve two problems at the same time and move Juliet Holness to that position. And could somebody like Delroy Chuck, who has experience in there, to hold for the year or so that is left, move somebody like Xavier Main, who is a good lawyer, into justice and who has served, has some ministerial, junior ministerial experience. It would solve two problems, because I think Mrs. Holness would be more comfortable with heavy equipment than the subtle nuances of the speakership.
The works portfolio has been vacant since Everald Warmington was relieved of his duties by the Prime Minister on February 29. Mr. Mitchell says Mrs. Holness, who now sits as the House Speaker, has the tools to successfully drive project implementation through the Works Ministry. He says a recent controversy over Mrs. Holness's handling of reports sent to Parliament by the Auditor General's Department, plus her public fallout with former clerk to the Houses of Parliament Valerie Curtis, suggests that her current role does not suit her skill set.
Well, I think Mrs. Holness would probably have to manage herself carefully in that position. But that position is critical now, because that is where most of the money is going to be spent leading up to the election. And Mrs. Holness does have considerable operational talents, and she does have an ability to get on the ground. She's demonstrated that. She also has experience in the area of construction and general infrastructure works. So yeah, you're going to get controversy anywhere you go.
Howard Mitchell speaking on Nationwide This Morning on Tuesday. In the meantime, Minister Morris Dixon, that's Dana Morris Dixon, who is in charge of skills and digital transformation, says that she's unaware of any move by the Prime Minister to shuffle his cabinet.
I'm not aware of that. I came in less than a year ago, and I'm enjoying what I'm doing, supporting the Prime Minister and the administration. And I don't even know that there is anything happening like what you had in your previous segment. I'm not aware of it. I think you need to talk to someone much higher than me to find out about that.
But the Skills and Digital Transformation Minister says she would not be averse to a change in her portfolio responsibilities.
I serve at the request of the Prime Minister. Whatever he gives me to do, I will do. But I don't know that he is planning to move any of us around.
Dr. Dana Morris Dixon, Minister with Responsibility for Skills and Digital Transformation. Now, the Minister, Dr. Dana Morris Dixon, in charge of Skills and Digital Transformation, is labeling as misinformation the contents of a WhatsApp message which asserts that Jamaicans will be forced to sign up under the National Identification System, NIDS. Dana Davey reports.
Minister Morris Dixon says enrollment in the NIDS program is strictly voluntary.
There's tons of misinformation and disinformation. The first thing I have to say is that NIDS is voluntary. The regulations, the law that was passed made it very clear that this is a voluntary process. No one is ever going to be forced to get a national ID. That is in law. And so any WhatsApp or anyone who says you will be forced is not communicating the truth.
Minister Morris Dixon says the claim that persons who choose not to subscribe to NIDS will be fined by the court is another myth.
So there can be no fine. In it, it speaks to a fine that's going to come if you do not do this. That is not accurate, because it is voluntary. Now, obviously, we think that people, it will become useful for people because it's supposed to make their lives easier and their interactions with government easier. But if someone does not want to get the ID, they do not have to get the ID. And I think that it is very mischievous for people to be spreading lies in this manner and to put it out as a newsflash.
And the minister says no Jamaican will be hindered from conducting business or accessing services if they do not have a national identification number, NIN.
There is no way that the state or the government can deny services to anyone. And I don't think anyone in the government would be trying to put in place a system that would deny these very important services to someone. And so this is why these types of WhatsApps are really dangerous.
Yes.
Because it sets people on high alert.
Yes.
You know, people start to get scared when there is absolutely no truth to it. And it's very dangerous
yes.
for our country.
Dana Davey for Nationwide News.
Commissioner of the Jamaica Fire Brigade, Stuart Beckford, says an illegal electricity connection was the cause of an early morning fire at a house on 7th Street, Greenwich Town in St. Andrew on Tuesday, in which three of his men were injured. Three of the firefighters received electric shocks.
It is an unfortunate situation, but it's not strange for firefighters doing firefighting operation to come in contact with electric wires, which in most instances are illegal connections, and that was the case this morning.
Commissioner Beckford says the firefighters' injuries are not considered life-threatening.
One of our members came in contact with live electrical wires. The others who were in close proximity to him, in their attempt to rescue him, would have also sustained electric shock. All three were rushed to the Kingston Public Hospital, where they have been admitted. They are in fairly high spirit. Their injuries are serious, but not considered life-threatening. There's one of the three that we are particularly concerned about, and we are in close contact with the medical team at KPH who is treating them, and they are confident that while their injuries are serious, they are not life-threatening.
Stuart Beckford, a commissioner of the Jamaica Fire Brigade. Meanwhile, the fire chief is appealing to residents to desist from making illegal connections to the electrical grid.
And so I want to make a special plea to householders, to desist from this practice. And not only does it pose a threat to your property and your household, but it also poses a threat to our firefighters. We could have easily lost three firefighters this morning. But we are grateful that the situation as it is not as bad as we were fearing when we got the call that the men were rushed to the Kingston Public Hospital with varying levels of injuries.
Stuart Beckford, a commissioner of the Jamaica Fire Brigade, and a Minister of Local Government and Community Development, Desmond McKenzie, is also calling on residents to be socially responsible and comply with the law. He says that the practice of illegal connection to the public power grid must cease as it presents a clear fire and electrocution risk. Minister McKenzie says that the job of a firefighter is already dangerous and residents should not deliberately increase their risk of injury or death. Mayor of St. Anne's Bay, Michael Bell-Navis, believes that the owners of businesses that do not have contracts for the proper disposal of garbage should be prosecuted. This comes as Montego Bay Mayor Richard Vernon revealed that 8 illegal dump sites were discovered during an eradication exercise in the parish on Sunday. Speaking on Nationwide at 5 on Monday, Mayor Bell-Navis says the issue of illegal dumping is also a cause for concern in St. Anne.
Well, this is a major, major concern right here in St. Anne. It translates itself to people just, whenever there's an open space, people just throw their garbage there, whether they're a truck man trying to cut the corners to prevent himself going all the way up to the hidden dump, or someone just, a fridge, stove, something inanimate, and wants to get rid of it, right into any old space that is there. So it's a major concern. Even the size of the highway, let's dump them out. So what we're able to do is, since we've gotten into this new dispensation, is that we have embarked on a solid waste pickup. So what we're doing now is we have vehicles going around picking up old garbage, old trucks, old cars, old fridges, stoves, things of that nature.
Mayor Bell-Navis says some business owners are paying people to dispose of their garbage in an illegal manner.
Sometimes it is not the supermarket owner or the business owner himself or herself that is disposing of the up, but they contract, quote unquote,
yes,
these individuals to go out there and do it. So what I've said was that solid waste needs to go to every business place in Orchard, as an example. And anyone who doesn't have a contract, you cannot show your contract for garbage disposal, then you just charge them. Because how else are you disposing of your garbage if you don't have some contract?
Michael Belnavis, mayor of St. Anne's Bay. Lawyers representing the Alliance Financial Group's former owners, Robert Chin and his brother Peter, have rubbished the Bank of Jamaica's assertion that a court reviewed and validated its decision to revoke the company's licenses. According to King's Counsel Tom Tavares Finson, the court ruled that Alliance Financial Services Limited's judicial review claim had realistic prospects of success. Joyce Michael tells us more.
Last week, the Bank of Jamaica defended the actions it took against the pair in 2021. These include the revocation of certain licenses, which jeopardized the operations of the business. This is despite a court later dismissing the criminal charges, which partly contributed to the entity's license revocation. KC Tavares Finson says the court granted the entity permission to bring a judicial review claim. However, the King's Counsel says the claim would have possibly taken months or years to be decided. He says the company would not have been able to operate for the entire period unless an interim injunction was granted by the court. That injunction was refused. In its ruling in 2022, the court recognized that damage would be done to the business by not being able to operate until the outcome of the review. But the court acceded to the BOJ's argument that the potential damage to the Jamaican economy and the financial sector outweighed the concern. The King's Counsel says the effect of the BOJ's suspension of Alliance Financial Services licenses and the length of time for a judicial review hearing were devastating. He says the actions of the BOJ left the Chins with no option but to sell their company to ensure the continuity of the business. He also says the BOJ's actions caused the severe and debilitating damage to the brand and the reputations of Peter Chin and Robert Chin. Shaloy Smichael for Nationwide News.
To regional and international news now, regional news. The mayor of Colombia's capital, Bogota, has announced new measures to reduce water consumption in the city of 8 million people. In a statement aired by local media, Bogota's Mayor Carlos Fernando Galan said homes that use more than 22 cubic meters of water per month will have to pay additional fees. He also threatened to impose fines of up to $300 on people who wash their cars on the streets or conduct other activities that are deemed to be a waste of water. The mayor said that city buses, which are usually washed every day, will now only be washed once per week. For public health reasons, the insides of the buses will still need to be cleaned on a daily basis. Water rationing is rare in Bogota, a city that is located in a humid patch of the northern Andes Mountains and is surrounded by cloud forests and emerald green fields. But several months of dry weather caused by the El Niño weather phenomenon have destabilized the city's reservoirs and led to forest fires in January. Bogota's main source of water, the Chingaza Reservoir System, is currently 15% full, its lowest level ever. Experts have warned that if rains do not return to the area, its reservoirs could run out of water in 2 months. In international news now, police in Australia have declared Monday's stabbing at a Sydney church a religiously motivated terrorist act. A 16-year-old boy was arrested after a bishop, a priest, and a churchgoers were attacked during Mass at the Assyrian Christ, the Good Shepherd Church. Police say at least 4 people suffered non-life-threatening injuries. The attacker was also hurt. The incident was captured on a church live stream and quickly triggered unrest in the suburb of Wakeley. Australian police define terror offences as being ideologically motivated. Investigations are still underway, but they say they're satisfied this is a case of religious extremism. Authorities have repeatedly declined to state the religion of the alleged attacker. The church has named the priest as Father Isaac Royal and the bishop as Mar Marie Emmanuel. Ordained in 2011, Bishop Emmanuel is seen as a popular and controversial figure whose sermons receive millions of views on social media. Also in international news this afternoon, the British government's plan to introduce a landmark smoking ban that aims to stop young people from ever smoking is expected to clear its first hurdle on Tuesday. The bill, a key policy announced by Prime Minister Rishi Sunak last year, will make it illegal to sell tobacco products to anyone born after January 1, 2009. It has the support of the opposition Labour Party and is expected to pass despite vocal opposition from within Sunak's Conservative Party. Sunak faces rebellion from more of the libertarian-minded members of his party who criticize the proposals as unconservative. If passed, the bill will give Britain some of the toughest anti-smoking measures in the world. Authorities say it will create modern Britain's first smoke-free generation. Under the Tobacco and Vapes Bill, children turning 15 this year or younger will never be legally sold tobacco. The legal age of sale that people in England can buy cigarettes will be raised by 1 year every year until it is eventually illegal for the whole population. The bill also includes measures to crack down on youth vaping, such as the banning sale or banning the sale of cheap disposable vapes and restricting their flavors to prevent children from becoming addicted to nicotine. It is currently illegal for anyone to sell cigarettes or tobacco products and vapes to people under 18 years old throughout the UK. And that's it for the local, regional and international segments at 12. Up next, sports.
The Midday News was brought to you by Total Tools. We almost always have it.
A time to double up your savings. These are the boost that you've been awaiting. Put in the words, the dreams you've been chasing. Double up your savings. Double up.
Save so you can win in the JN Bank Double Up Your Savings promotion. You could be one of five lucky quarterly winners to walk away with double the money you put in your savings account. Conditions apply.
Double up your savings.
Check our website and social media for details. JN Bank will help you find a way. Authorized under Section 58(3) of the Betting, Gaming and Lotteries Act.
From the Nationwide News Network, comprehensive, up-to-the-minute local and international sports news, this is the Nationwide Sports at Noon.
Good afternoon with your sports report. I am Alex Raby. We start with track and field as reigning World Championships double sprint champion Noah Lyles is set to headline the sixth staging of the Racers Grand Prix track and field meet at the National Stadium on June 1. Lyles, who's arguably the biggest name in the sport, will run in the men's 100 meters against the man he relegated to bronze at last year's World Championships, Zarnell Hughes, and Oblique Seville, who was fourth. Both Seville and Hughes are looking forward to the rematch. Seville says he's happy to get an early look at two of the top sprinters in the world ahead of the Olympics.
Very excited. The last time I competed with Lyles, which was the first time, was the World Championship final. So it's good to run with him before the actual Olympics to get a feel of what is to come to the Olympic Championship.
Oblique Seville. Hugh says it's good for the sport that some of the top sprinters can race against each other this early in the season.
Excellent thing. I think it's a great thing. I'm happy Coach Glenn Mills and Devin and those guys were able to organize it. I think it's exceptional for us athletes. As you mentioned, many of us top sprinters, we try to avoid each other. And this is Olympic year, so there's no ducking. So for me, I'm excited to go there and race against these guys. I know Oblique and I have been training pretty good, and we're looking forward to going out there and, battling it out. At the end of the day, we are going to be good friends at it. But when we line up on the starting line, it's proper rivalry.
Zarnell Hughes. The men's 100 meters is among 13 events on the program. The women's equivalent will feature newly minted world indoor champion Julian Alfred, Alana Reed, and Ashanti Moore. Reigning Olympic bronze medalist Megan Tapper and Akira Nugent will be in the women's sprint hurdles. The men's sprint hurdles will have Olympic champion Hansel Parchment. Other events on the card are the 400 meters, 400 meters hurdles, long and triple jump men and discus men. National triple jump champion Jaden Hibbert will clash with American Will Clay in the men's triple jump. Clay is the third longest triple jumper in history. The Sports Development Foundation, through the Ministry of Sports, will donate $10 million to the staging of the meet. Finish line tickets will go on sale on May 1 for $5,000, regular grandstand $3,000, and bleachers admission is $500. Technical director of Cavalier Rudolf Speed says his team worked hard to secure a top two finish in the preliminary round of the Ray and Never Jamaica Premier League. Cavalier finished second with 54 points from 26 starts. They gained the second place following their 6-0 whipping of Moulins United and Tivoli Gardens 2-1 defeated against Montego Bay United in the final round of the preliminary round. Speed says making the top two helped them to avoid the quarterfinals.
We really wanted the top two spots because of our particular circumstances. One, I don't know if you noticed that every time we went away and played in the Caribbean, we came up with the game, or we dropped form. So one of the factors there was fatigue. We were very tired, the team. I mean, we started with a small squad and built after the school finished. So the players are just dead beat, and we're just desperate to get into the top two to get a rest.
He dismissed the myth that teams that finish in the top two will find it difficult to win the league.
What happened is that over the past couple of seasons, and probably a couple of seasons before, teams have barely made the playoff and has won. So there's a false narrative to say that if you come first or second, you can't win. But that's not true, because Portmore had done it like 2 years before in a row. We had come second when we won it. So I think it's even, Steven. The truth is that everybody has their own individual situation to deal with. And coaches in Jamaica are getting better. They know how to condition team better. There's games that they have as practice games. So I don't think it's really a factor now. I, for one, if mother tried to put it on my radar, whatever we have to do, we just have to do and we'll prepare accordingly.
Rudolf Speed. Meanwhile, Tivoli play Waterhouse and Arnott Gardens take on Portmore United in the first leg of the quarterfinals at Sabina Park on April 22. Barcelona could reach their first UEFA Champions League semi-final since 2018-2019 if they can see off PSG in the return fixture this afternoon at 2. The Catalans are in a strong form since Xavi announced his decision to leave at the end of the season with a 13-game unbeaten run across all competitions, which has included 10 wins. Barcelona lead 3-2 from the first leg. Meanwhile, Borussia Dortmund host Atletico Madrid in the second leg of their quarterfinal tie, trailing 2-1 from the first leg. Dortmund have failed to get past the quarterfinals since the 2012-2013 season, when they went on to lose to Bayern Munich in the final. Atletico Madrid last reached the semifinals in 2016-2017. On to cricket, as coach of the West Indies, Darren Sammy, says they'll use the West Indies A-team tour of Nepal as part of their preparation for the ICC T20 World Cup in the Caribbean and USA. The Caribbean side will face their hosts in five T20 internationals from April 27 to May 4.
It is an A-team tour, but more or less we will use it as preparation to give guys more practice leading up to the World Cup. We have five T20 matches versus Nepal. Obviously, they will also use it as preparation for them coming here in the Caribbean. But we will use that to fine-tune one or two spots missing, and it creates more opportunities for guys to further select themselves. We also have three T20s against South Africa just before the World Cup starts.
Sammy says they are also closely monitoring the players competing in the IPL.
We've given all the guys in the IPL both a physical program that was communicated through our strength and conditioning trainer, Ronald Rogers, to make sure that our guys are not burning out. So by the time they come out of the IPL, they're still fresh. Also, James Franklin, who is the bowling consultant for us, he's out there and he's given out bowling workloads. As you've noticed, some of our guys are not playing, but they know they have a week-by-week schedule as to the amount of work they have to put in and keep themselves ready, even whilst they're not playing.
He says the coaching staff and the West Indies board are clear on the importance for the team to do well during the World Cup.
The director has also made it very, very easy in terms of the communication, understanding what we need as a team, helping us and putting those measures in place for us, especially with the different camps. Also, we'll have a camp leading up to the World Cup in Antigua starting on the 10th of May as well. So the biggest thing for us has been preparation, and it shows that when we prepare well, we've given ourselves the best chance of performing. And that is something we as a group have not taken for granted. That is why throughout 2023, we did not lose a T20 series.
Darren Sammy, and finally, coach of Manchester High cricket team Barry Barnes, admits that Excelsior will start favourite when both teams meet in the All-Ireland Sporting Cup on April 24. The venue is yet to be decided. Excelsior qualified for the All-Ireland competition following their 420 runs triumph over St. Jago in the final of the ISA First Global Bank Grey Shield Trophy. Meanwhile, Manchester booked their place after beating Mayday High by 140 runs in the ISA GK Insurance Grace Headley Cup final. Barnes says he's familiar with the quality of Excelsior's squad.
Yeah, I know it's a hard task. I am around most of the boys from Excelsior. I am the chairman of Excelsior, the Jamaican under 19. So I know them very well. I know the good players that were invited to the trials. And I know that it will be a hard task. But I just want my boys to remain focused, enjoy the game, irrespective of what transpires. I'm just going to enjoy that game against Excelsior because I will be feeling more relaxed playing against Excelsior because Excelsior remain will be out as favourite. So that makes me feel much better.
He says all-rounder Michael Clark will be the danger man for Excelsior.
Michael Clark is a very good player. He's a guy that can change the game. He bats well. He bowls a stiff medium pace. I think he will be the difference between Manchester and Excelsior.
Barry Barnes. I'm Alric Swibby, and that's your sports.
Welcome, me lots. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
When you're good, you're just good.
Hey,
had the national flavor. You're gonna want to buy this bag.
So good, it's just so good.
Welcome, me lots. The cream cracker that rises to the top.
So crisp, so light, so buttery.
National Baking Company. Just so, so good.
To recap our top stories making the nationwide world at noon, police say there's nothing yet to confirm reports that human remains were found in a shallow grave in a part of the corporate area called Bowtie Land. Businessman Howard Mitchell wants Juliet Holness to be the next Minister of Works amid talks of a cabinet reshuffle. The Minister of Digital Transformation dismisses claims made about the NIDS program as myths and lies. Firefighters injured after shocking encounter with illegal electricity connection. And 76 rounds of ammunition seized in Potsdam, St. Elizabeth. I'm Atona Thomas. You can find the news on our website at nationwideradiojm.com and on the Nationwide app available on Google Play and the App Store. Major news next at 5.
You didn't know so the government decreased JUTC bus fares? Yes, it's now 70 for adults, 25 for children and 30 for pensioners. And in April, fares will go down even further to 50 for adults, 20 for children and 25 for pensioners.
The time by the Office of the Prime Minister is...
12:34.
Hey, mama.
They claim to want men who respect and treat women well, and like no other, a man's mother is the first exam to be tested, not true? Then why would a man treat his first love less just because he has a wife and a girlfriend? Is it a biblical thing about no longer clinging to the body of birth? On the other foot, being labeled a mama's boy means your dependency on a maternal figure is too deep for a grown man. No man not really give a damn mother still. But wait, imagine a man who treats you like a queen throne and treats his mother like a question sign. Imagine a man full up your house of furniture and a six burner stove while mama there home a chop wood fire. Something can really go so? That a good man? Join me, Rodney Campbell, every Tuesday from 9 to 10:30 p.m. for Affairs of the Heart, right here on Nationwide 90 FM. This Tuesday's topic, when you're grown, who come first? Mama or your mate?
No one knows the pressure you bear, just only you. It's my words and my turn.
Brought to you by SuperMed Pharmacy. Super happy, super healthy, SuperMed.
If you're into real estate, then you're going to love this. Cliff Hughes Online will broadcast live from the second staging of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo, April 19 at the Montego Bay Convention Center. The expo will be from April 18 to 20. Hear expert presentations on April 18 and 19, then explore the Homeowners Expo on April 19 and 20. With giveaways, DJs, and live entertainment, it's the perfect outing for everyone, and the admission is free. That's a live broadcast of the International Real Estate Conference and Homeowners Expo during Cliff Hughes Online, April 19 from 10 a.m. to 1 p.m. at the Montego Bay Convention Center. Only on Nationwide 90 FM, the new revolution in media. This broadcast is brought to you by 2020 Jamaica and Creative Building Finishes.
Watch for Shelly and Price and Price.
I stay locked to the Olympics because, of course, I'm Jamaican. What do you mean? Me, I have to tune into the Olympics, man. Because I'm always busy, but what? I have to know when Sherika Jackson beat Shakari.
Brother, I have to have every notification for the Olympics. I want to hear every run.
Now Sherika Jackson coming
every
up.
Every jump.
Well, that is absolutely huge of Wayne Pinkham.
And every fling, live.
So, take us then.
Nothing can miss me.
We're always on the move.
So while we're driving,
run, Elaine, run.
Jogging.
Yes!
Run, Watson! Win again!
Watson is now a world champion!
Or even at work!
Quick! The race has started!
We can't miss a beat because we keep it locked
to the only station
for the Paris Olympics.
Nationwide.
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 90 FM.
Nationwide, 90.1, 90.3, 90.5, 90.7, and 90.9. And on YouTube at Nationwide 90 FM Live. Nationwide, the new revolution in media.
Cliff Hughes Online. Talk radio for all Jamaicans.
My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light.
Timeline. With the stinger, Honey Bee.
It's 22 minutes going up to 1 o'clock. It's all about what's trending on the timeline now with my favorite girl, Honey Bee.
Ow. How have you been? I feel like, you know, it's
I'm
been
good.
A minute.
Yes, it's been a while.
Yeah, where did you go yesterday?
We were on an outside broadcast at the Pegasus.
Oh, fancy.
And I wasn't here on Friday, so we have been missing each other.
That is very true. That is very true. And quite a bit has happened since then. In fact, I can't wait to tell you about Meta AI. All right.
Meta AI.
Yes. But before we get into it, just a few local things. It's festival time again.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. And the Jamaica Cultural Development Commission, JCDC, will host its annual Festival of the Performing Arts National Finals from Tuesday, April 16, 2024, to Friday, May 3, 2024. Have you ever entered JCDC?
No.
Because you know, it is not easy to get to. We're saying about the talent there.
No,
not even for Selica poem.
I did. That's not true.
Mm.
In grade two
and
grade three, at primary school, I did a speech festival.
Ah.
Godfrey Gordon Gustavius Gore. No, it was an individual and I won gold.
What?
Yeah. I performed at what was the name of the cinema house in Crossroads? YouTubers and not
yeah,
liquor
YouTubers
theater.
Will remember that.
It's now where the Azan Supercenter is. Mm-hmm. What was the name of it?
Indeed, what was the name of it?
In Crossroads. Oh Lord, it's on the tip of my tongue.
But I mean, grade two and
grade,
you got gold.
Grade two and grade three. Yeah, and I won gold medal in the speech competition.
That's really something.
Yeah?
Yes, of course. What are you talking about?
I never remember.
No, that is a very good... Listen, it's very difficult to get gold in JCDC.
Yeah?
It is. You have to be at your very best.
Oh.
And you went in for speech?
Speech.
English?
Poem.
No, Miss Ayers.
I did poetry and I got gold medal. Mm-mm. Yeah, Mrs. Poyser Davis prepared me from Chatola Park Primary school.
Wow.
Regal. See, I know the YouTubers.
Regal, of course.
Regal theater it was.
Wow.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
That's where I performed.
Nicey?
Yeah, man.
And
but I never kept it up in high school.
Mm.
Yeah?
If you did, I feel like, you know, you would have done very well at it. Because if you were in grade two and grade three and getting gold, then obviously you had something very special. And that's why you're here in media.
Oh, really? Yeah. Didn't think
One
of
the
that.
Top journalists. I mean, being able to orate, you know, and to speak.
You know, you take these things for granted.
No, you do, but it's from the formative years, yeah, mm-hmm. that these things
yeah,
are developed.
Mrs. Poyser Davis of blessed memory and Mrs. Taylor
mm-hmm.
at Chatola Park, they prepared us.
Wow. Mm. Big up to the teachers that, you know, ensure that we were ready. Now, this will feature creations across the areas of traditional folk forms, drama, theater arts, speech, dance, deaf dance, drum fest, and music, affording the performers the opportunity to cop a national title within these respective areas. Now, admission to the national finals is free. However, there is limited seating capacity at the venue. So if you want to support, of course, our cultural development, you can visit their website for more information, JCDC's website, because they will also be streaming as well. Yep, sweet. Okay, moving on. This will be big. Now, the Marley Brothers are set to hit the road together for the first time in over 20 years. Okay, Ziggy, Stephen, Julian, Kimani, and Damian Marley.
Yeah.
Sweet, right?
That's going to be powerful.
Yes, yes. They have officially announced their 2024 The Legacy Tour.
Wow.
Right off the bat of the movie. Smart.
Yes.
Smart.
Them no
very
from
smart.
It money.
Of course. September to October 5. It makes sense.
Of course.
With this momentum.
Yeah.
Guan out there. People
the Marley
spend.
Boys.
Mm-hmm. Sweet. Now, the brothers who usually joined each other on their respective tours are set to give fans the complete Marley experience of all the musical siblings starting in September. If you're watching on YouTube, you can see a picture of them there together. Look at his son. So cute. Now, Salik Jamaica shared that Stephen and Damian are now on their joint Traffic Jam tour, because Stephen and Damian, they've always been close and they've always sort of toured together. Or once one of them release an album, they have a song together. You know what I mean? They really support each other, and I really like that. While Julian, Kimani, and Ziggy Marley are all active on their respective festivals and show commitments, they're all going to come together, guys, in September. Exciting. You can see a list of all the cities that they will be. I mean, I see Kingston upon it still, but you know.
Vancouver, Ridgefield, Auburn. Yeah. Concord, Shula, Phoenix, Arizona, Albuquerque in New Mexico, Austin. Mm. Yeah.
All over.
But Kingston are the planet.
I mean, I say, I feel like they could, but yeah. It is what it is. Mm. Okay, moving on. O.J. Simpson's brain won't be donated. So in case you were thinking that they were going to get a chance to study his brain, okay, it's not going
to
happen.
And why would they want to study OJ's brain?
Well, I mean, look, okay, it's he's a pretty unique guy. He's had a pretty unique life. But also, apparently, they do these particular studies on football players. It's a condition called encephalopathy.
Oh.
Yes, yes. It's a degenerative brain disease that has been studied on football players and is associated with behavioral and cognitive issues related to repeated head injuries.
Uh-huh.
Because, you know, the sport.
Yes.
Yeah, finger dung, it pick you
up. It's a hazard of that sport.
It is. It is. But according to his lawyer, O.J. Simpson, who passed away from cancer last week at 76, will be cremated.
Mm.
Yep, yep. Have you ever thought of that, Mr. Hughes?
No.
Yeah? Do you... Yeah, I want to be cremated. Yeah. Yes, so guys, in case you wanted to study him, it's not going to happen. Now, his lawyer, Malcolm Laverne, told People magazine that all goes into the crematorium. Everything is, every part of his body, his brain, his fake hips, his fake knees, everything. Wow, I didn't even know he had fake hips and fake knees. Yes, but Laverne, who is now serving as the executor of Simpson's estate, said there are tentative plans for a celebration of life, gathering limited to close friends and family. Understandable. All right, moving on. Turbulence issues warning. The dancehall slash reggae singer shared that scammers exploited his identity to fabricate a fraudulent social media profile, deceiving promoters out of approximately £3,000. We have a clip here. Let's throw to it.
Look at my face, good. Look at my face. I'm going to stop ramp for the people. Live visions. AKA Never Stop Booking is a real one. Link up. Those are the real people. Those are the real agents. You don't want nobody get it twisted. But if you find a different fake page and find a different number and talk to some people, me not responsible for no.
Well, on the matter of fake, yeah? And artificial, yeah? Let's talk about Meta.
Okay.
Yes, so WhatsApp's Meta AI experiment is now live for users.
They were showing me yesterday in the newsroom.
Yeah?
That's that what it's is about, scary.
Mr. Hughes. That's what it's about.
But,
so.
You know, Sierra over there,
yeah.
They were there playing with me and said, okay, they put in my name.
Yes.
And within 3-4 seconds.
Seconds.
It told me a lot about who I am, what I do,
yeah,
whatever. But it failed because it could not produce a current photograph of me. It gave me one man looked like about 90.
Yes, so it's in the testing phases right now.
Uh-huh.
Yes, still. So Meta Artificial Intelligence really is, Facebook has rolled it out across Facebook, WhatsApp, and Instagram.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm telling you, Mr. Hughes, it can produce essays in seconds, as they say. Seconds, mm-hmm. You just ask it. Write an essay on colorism in Jamaica, and bam, 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 there it is in front of you. It is insane. Now, so I asked the one on Instagram. I was like, who is Cliff Hughes?
Oh,
so
you did.
I did. So it's like Cliff Hughes is an Emmy Award-winning journalist who hosts a midday radio talk show called Cliff Hughes Online on Nationwide 90 FM. He is the principal of Nationwide News Network and has been involved in politics and journalism in Jamaica for many years.
I was never involved in politics.
Well, based on... Remember what he's doing. Oh, no,
that's not true. That's not true. Yes, I was involved in politics when I was a teenager. That's true.
When he was
okay, they got it. They got it right.
But they might draw from a lot of public sources, you know. Like, that's what the AI is doing really quickly. Like, any headlines and anything like that, anything that stands out.
Uh-huh.
It says, and I didn't know this, and you can tell me if it's true. He was also the director of television at the Jamaica Broadcasting Corporation, JBC, in the 1990s.
Yes.
I was like, what?
Yes.
We never knew that.
That's true.
Interesting.
Yeah.
So I was like, wow, this is something else.
Whoa.
I know. I know. So we've been playing around with it. I'm putting in people's names and so on. I think yesterday, Jermaine Smith, you know him, called himself DJ Razzie because he plays music as well. So he put in like, who's DJ Razzie? So the AI was like, oh, well, we're not quite sure. It appears he's not very popular. And hello, it is something else. It is something else. Oh, my gosh.
No, you need to put in DJ David McNeish.
But I don't say any name, David.
No, he has a
What's
name.
What's his DJ name? What's your DJ name?
What is your name? Kosha the Soldier.
Kosha the Soldier. Who you spell is it? K-O-S-H-A D-I S-O S-O what? J-H J-A-H. Okay. All right. Who is Kosha the Soldier? All right. So it is typing. It says Keisha the Soca is a Jamaican media personality, socialite, and entrepreneur.
Oh?
She is known for her vibrant personality and her work in the entertainment industry.
That's not David.
In the fields of media. It's not David. So sometimes it does mix up. Like, sometimes what he does is autocorrect because he thinks that, oh, you're putting in the wrong information.
Mm-hmm.
So yesterday, Natalie asked it, is Honey Bee in a relationship?
Oh!
Said, respond, I know, right? Mr. Hughes, it can do also the small images it can generate. Okay? So it says, as you know, because it said it showed you an older picture of yourself.
Yes.
But it can also generate nudes. And yeah, and Facebook is coming under, you know, a lot of scrutiny. They have to change a lot of the regulations and how it does that and whether that's okay or not, because it can generate just nudes of people.
Ooh.
Yes. Yes. Okay, so it says, I couldn't find any information on Honeybee's relationship status. However, Honika Honeybee Brown and Kareem Boy Ting's Weathers replaced Miss Kitty on Nationwide News Network in January 2023. If you're interested in learning more about Honeybee, I suggest checking out her recent music releases. So obviously it's, I know, right? So obviously it's using, like, as you say, headlines and like stuff that it can publicly just grab. You know what I mean? And then we asked it, who is Nora Gay Banton?
Mm-hmm.
Okay? So it's like, Nora Gay Banton.
Let me hear this now.
Nora Gay Banton seems to be a multi-talented individual with various interests and pursuits. Oh. She has been mentioned as a journalist working with Nationwide News, as well as a percussionist performing with the University Chorale.
Oh.
Additionally, she has been credited as a co-director for a short film entry in a competition. Her diverse involvement in different fields suggests a versatile and engaged individual.
I didn't know she was a percussionist. I didn't know that.
Nora playing a... Yeah.
Oh!
Now I do our thing when she tell you the answer. So you see, like, you can discover, but the issue with it is sieving through what is true and what is not true. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
And this is going to upend our lives.
It's,
you know,
going to, because now you get one SFA, right? You really just have to put the topic in there and sort of copy and paste, paraphrase, and you've got a whole.
Yeah.
It's like.
I can do at least half of the work for
at
you.
At least half of the work.
Yeah, so you're not going to get people's true abilities anymore.
No.
It's those who are best able
exactly.
to manipulate the technology who will do better. But then what are we going to get at the end of the day?
Yeah.
Yeah, in terms of quality. Yeah. No, we're in uncharted waters.
We are in uncharted waters, and so that's why the regulatory bodies, you know, they really have to sit with these AI companies and really sort out how they're going to represent and just make these the lines. There has to be lines.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? Because they can't be allowed to just do anything, you know? And especially, I saw an article that was talking about the fact that elections are coming up and so on. And if they can do this sort of thing and get your face and get your body and your voice to be saying things and doing things, and if that's admissible on these social media platforms, then the whole issue with Russia, you know, swaying the elections when Trump won, please, that would be the least of concerns.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Because now anyone can do it. Yeah.
Why?
Yes.
No. Before you go, I just remembered the people of Hermitage Dam.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the dam up in West Rose, St. Andrew.
Yes.
I met a couple of them on the weekend walking. And they said to me, you know, Mr. Hughes, we live so close to the dam, and yet we don't have any running water here. We don't have any pipe water here. They have a standpipe. A standpipe. One woman told me she's been living there for more than 40 years near the Hermitage Dam. And them still have to catch water.
How?
Yeah. And them live less than a mile. Yeah?
Mm-hmm.
Of the dam.
Yeah.
And they asked me, please, Mr. Hughes, the Water Commission, yeah? how can you have that situation?
Yes.
They have a standpipe. And then one of them said to me, the road, the condition of the road is bad. The surface of the road is terrible. When you walk, you have to be careful.
Mm-hmm.
Got my age, me can't broke my ankle.
Oh, boy.
Mm-hmm. And the point is that the Water Commission has not really, and the government has not really facilitated the development around there because they don't want people near to the dam. I said,
so it's in an effort to get people to move from the
or
area?
Not to go there, not to settle there. Yeah.
But people are there nonetheless.
People are there. People are there. And now no running water, no pipe water except a standpipe. And you have to go catch up water and you live. Yeah,
right.
Within
there's
a stones throughout the
of
dam.
Of the dam. Mm-hmm. And then something just, you know, add up, Mr. Hughes.
Mm-mm, not at all.
Oh, my.
Anyway, thank you so much, Honeybee.
You're welcome.
Yeah, we're going to leave it there for today. Thanks to all of our callers, our contributors, our YouTubers, and, of course, our producer, Norege Banton, the percussionist, and our technical operator, Kosha, whatever, Jaja.
Kosha, Soja.
I'm Cliff Hughes. We'll make way now for Oasis with Loy Gale.
Start your fitness goals with Express Fitness. Sign up today and restart your fitness journey at an Express Fitness location near you. Enjoy safe, comfortable, and well-equipped gyms from 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. daily. Call 554-5180 for a full listing of our open locations. Express Fitness.
Express Fitness.
Your goal. Our mission.
Time for a new look.
And high time to get serious about protecting our home and investment.
It's time to choose BH Paints with over 60 years experience in quality paint finishes. Their products are superior and long-lasting.
Time to check them out.
Ask about BH Paints 100% Acrylic Ultima Plus paint and primer in one. Experience rich colors with advanced UV and mildew-resistant technologies, independently tested by experts. What are you waiting for? Visit a BH Paints Color Center today.
You've just heard Cliff Hughes Online on Nationwide 90 FM. Join Cliff Monday to Thursdays between 10 a.m. and 1 p.m. for Cliff Hughes Online.
Like a rock. My hands were steady. My eyes were clear and bright. My walk had purpose. My steps were quick and light. And I held firm to what I felt was right. Like a rock. Like a rock. I was strong as I could be. Like a rock. Nothing ever got to me. Like a rock. I was something to see. Like a rock. And I stood arrow straight, unencumbered by the weight of all these hustlers and their schemes.
Welcome to Oasis. Stop by for a refreshing drink as we share the Pauline letters. As relevant to us now as they were to those to whom they were addressed in the Apostle Paul's day.
Hi, I'm Loy Gale. Thanks for joining me. Have you ever wondered if all the help you give has been of benefit to anybody? Do you wish you could see something a little more positive out of your efforts? Don't despair. Stick with me as the Apostle Paul bears his heart. Earlier, before you knew God personally, You were enslaved to so-called gods that had nothing of the divine about them. But now that you know the real God, or rather, since God knows you, how can you possibly subject yourselves again to those tin gods? For that is exactly what you do when you are intimidated into scrupulously observing all the traditions, taboos, and superstitions associated with special days and seasons and years. I am afraid that all my hard work among you has gone up in a puff of smoke. My dear friends, what I would really like you to do is try to put yourselves in my shoes to the same extent that I, when I was with you, put myself in yours. You were very sensitive and kind then. You did not come down on me personally. You were well aware the reason I ended up preaching to you was that I was physically broken, and so, prevented from continuing my journey, I was forced to stop with you. That is how I came to preach to you. And don't you remember that even though taking in a sick guest was most troublesome for you, you chose to treat me as well as you would have treated an angel of God, as well as you would have treated Jesus himself if he had visited you. What has happened to the satisfaction you felt at that time? There were some of you then who, if possible, would have given your very eyes to me. That is how deeply you cared. And now have I suddenly